Good evening and welcome to the Hanger Events Centre here in Wolverhampton. We're here for a night of boxing, BCB Promotions. The show titled Someone's O Has Got To Go. Joined tonight with BCB's Dan Moll. Dan, as always, there's always a change, there's always something happening, a different main event. Talk us through what's gone on.
Yeah, it's been a difficult couple of days, Paul. We were looking forward to that Midland area title fight between Conor Walker and Jamie Stewart. And then sadly on Wednesday, Jamie failed his brain scan. And it was a fraught 24 hours where we looked for an opponent to replace Jamie. Thankfully, Jack Eubank from Kent has stepped in. He's 4-0. So it'll be another tough test for Conor Walker. Conor's putting his O on the line. Jack's putting his O on the line. And as the new name of the show suggests, someone's O has got to go this evening.
And as you alluded to there, both unbeaten fighters. Jack Eubank will be coming here with really nothing to lose on such short notice. Potentially could be a real danger fight for Conor.
Yeah, absolutely. Like you rightly say, Jack's got absolutely nothing to lose. 2 days ago, he didn't even know he was in a fight. He's turned up on weight. And that's the most important thing, the message that we always say to fighters, to stay in the gym and stay ready. Jack Eubank's done that and he's got his opportunity this evening, but I just think that Conor will have a bit too much for him in every department.
The show will also feature several four-round bouts, including several debutants. Dan, who's a couple of names that people should be keeping an eye on?
Yeah, look, all four debutants. We've linked him with Richie Carter's Wolverhampton Boxing Club. So we've got Lewis Morris, we've got Alex Round, we've got Jermaine Osborne Edwards, we've got Ollie Cooper, all local lads from Cannock, Wolverhampton, Wensfield, Blockswich. Be really good to see those four guys get the debut. Great to see Kirsty Babington back in action, a real Wolverhampton lass, played for Wolves during her footballing career. And then we've also got Ethan Collins, who fought on his debut literally 3 weeks ago. Enjoyed it that much, he's back out tonight.
Now, as we say, it's BCB's third proper show since it was 10 after lockdown. But our first big event, it's just great to be back. We've got the lights, we've got the people. It's a great thing, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. We dipped our toe in the water with two dinner shows over the last couple of weeks. Tonight's our first real test back. 7-fight card, sold out arena, massive show. Really looking forward to it, Paul.
Absolutely. We'll be joined on commentary tonight by former English champion Carl Williams. We'd also like to say a big thank you to our sponsors of the show this evening, GPW Consulting, Jobsworth Recruitment and Alliance Scaffolding. Please like and make comments. We'll try and interact. We'll get Carl answer any questions that you have. And everyone enjoy the show. Hello everyone and welcome to the Wolverhampton Hangar events. As we say, we are here for a full night of boxing. I'm joined with former English champion and British title challenger Kyle Williams. Kyle, we're back fighting in a place you're very familiar. It's a stacked show again. It's just great to be back ringside, isn't it?
Listen, Wolverhampton's crowd always come out and support their own. Last time I was here it was full to the rafters, and it's exactly the same again tonight. So it's really good to see, and I'm sure that tonight's boxing will be very entertaining.
As I say, that last minute change in the main event, obviously Conor Walker's opponent having to pull out because of the brain scan issue. What do you think that does to a fighter, you know, on a couple of days' notice, completely changing who he's going to be in with? It's a different opponent, someone he may have not seen much of at all, or his training team. It puts a lot of pressure on Conor.
We've seen it a lot recently in a lot of the TV shows due to COVID and stuff like that. There's been a lot of changes with opponents and people taking losses. But I'm sure Conor's got a very good established team around him under Richard Gent, and I'm sure his mind will be fully on the job. I believe that Conor will get through this as a talented lad. I've seen Conor for many years box, and from the amateur scene to the pro scene, he took everything in his stride, so I'm sure he'll deal with this with the man that's in front of him tonight. But the guy comes in unbeaten, and when someone's unbeaten, they don't know how to lose, of course. So it's going to make a very entertaining fight. Someone's always got to go, as they say. But I'm behind our man Conor Walker tonight.
Carl, there's a number of debutants making there, obviously their first walk to the ring this evening. It's been a couple of years since that was the case for yourself. It's probably not matched, is it?
What was that, sorry?
So a lot of guys making their first fight tonight, making their professional debuts. Can you remember back to your debut?
Yeah, I remember I made my debut at Walsall Town Hall, a historic BCB promotions venue, really. Many great nights down there, and it was it was an exciting but nervous night for me. I came from kickboxing to professional boxing, so there was a lot of pressure whether I'd be able to make that change. Some of these lads are coming from the amateur scene and stepping into the pro ranks, but I'm sure they'll just take in their stride. This Lewis Morris I've actually sparred. He's under the guidance of Richard Carter, which I have sparred him. He's a sharp kid. But I'm also in the gym all the time with Reese, who we call Showy. So this will make an interesting start to the night.
Absolutely, our first part coming up, Lewis Morris taking on Reese Taylor over 4 minute rounds. Lewis just 19 years of age. He looks a young lad, but he's raring to go.
I think Lewis had a good stint in the amateurs. I'm sure he's a very long amateur career.
Two appearances in the junior championships, and as you say, a good amateur background. Very, very different test tonight with someone as experienced as Reese Taylor.
And listen, I've sparred Reese. Everyone knows him as Showy, but Reese, yeah. I've sparred him in the gym. He's so frustrating because he's quite small. Sometimes you just can't get to him, and he can frustrate you, and you overcommit on your shots, and you end up falling over the top of him because he's so small. So Reese today will have to make sure that weight is on his back foot and take his time with Reese. Otherwise, he could end up making this a little bit scrappy. So it'll be interesting to see how he sets out from round one.
As we say, so a lot of guys, when they're making their debuts, they sometimes go a little bit over-eager in the early rounds, and it can cause problems, but hopefully that won't be the case for Lewis this evening.
Yeah, we should extend that back foot and use that long jab. Obviously, he's got the height. He's got the height on Reese as Lewis. So get behind that jab, mix the levels from high to low. From high to low early. And just keep showing backed up really, but not overcommit on that second shot.
So Morris in the black shorts with the gold trim. As we say, Sherry Reese Taylor, black shorts with the green trim. See, Lewis has got a good amount of support in there from this evening.
You can see already how low Showy is, so that makes it quite difficult to land that first shot because he fades. But there, it was good though with that backhand there.
Yeah, again, Morris certainly not a tall boxer, but he looks huge in there, doesn't he?
And this is what Showy's going to do. He's going to try and hold off and then just jump on him and surprise Lewis Morris here.
So Taylor in that southpaw stance. It's an awkward style. He makes himself very small, very compact. I think it's going to require a fair bit of patience from Morris.
And this is what I'm saying, that's the danger of this fight against Reese, is that you can make him miss with your first shot and then you over-ego on your second shot, which you end up falling over the top of him. There's a few times he's gone over the top of him, but there's a few times that he's measured that backhand really well and landed right on the chin. So let's see if he can do a little bit more of that tonight.
Right hand by Morris just fell a little bit short, but holding the centre of the ring and looking to establish that jab early on.
I'd like to see him bring that rear hand up the middle rather than straight down the centre. Bring it up rather than straight. Because if you notice, Showy dips to his left hand side.
Nice foot movement from Taylor there as he ducks in and out. And again, just pouring with his own jab. And Morris is showing good patience. He's flicking the jab out without a huge amount of intent behind it. And wild right hand miss there, and Taylor looks to grab him. What you were saying, Carl, about, you know, being patient and warming your way into the fight and not being too over-eager with that huge crowd support.
And that's all it is. He's going to want to obviously impress on his debut, and sometimes that can make you a little bit too over-eager as well.
It's better for Morris, who turns and gets Taylor in the corner, but he manoeuvres himself out
there. I'd like to see him just feign that. Let's see that uppercut there. He threw a short little right-hand uppercut and it hit him. It hit the target perfectly. He needs to do more of that. He needs to change his angles on his shots. Stop looking so straight all the time. Start bringing them up and round a little bit more.
There certainly are plenty of southpaws out there, but it's a different sort of challenge, isn't it? You know, you have to think a little bit more and think differently, as obviously Anthony Joshua found out last weekend. It presents a whole raft of challenges.
I prefer fighting southpaws, personally. But maybe that's just going to switch it and it doesn't bother me. But
slip there from Taylor. Referee just dusts the gloves off. A wild sequence there. Both men missing by almost a foot each.
It's just so hard to get your measurement on Reese, because he's so small and he's unorthodox, as in he jumps in and out of range from like 0 to 100 all the time. There's never any measured work by what Reese does. He goes from 0 to 100. So Reese he's always trying to measure that distance, but that sometimes can take your time away from your landing your shots.
Thank you for those joining us on Facebook Live. As I say, we have that main event coming up later, Conor Walker and Jack Eubank. Both undefeated guys. Someone's always got to go, as the show is entitled. Plenty of action before that. Heading into the second round of this one, scheduled for 4, our opening bout of the evening.
Obviously, Richard Carter in the corner of Lewis Morris. He was also a very successful pro.
He's got a number of guys on the show, Richard, tonight, hasn't he? You know, it's this. Boxing's always been there in the area, but it seems to be in a bit of a good place right now.
Yeah, it's growing. Wolverhampton's growing. I mean, I run my own boxing club, and since the opening back up of the COVID restrictions, boxing seems to be on a massive high. It's crazy.
And it's good for the area having a venue like this, trying to get bigger than small hall, but not arena size. There aren't a lot of them out there, but this seems to be ticking quite a few boxes.
It's a great venue. I really love boxing there. Oh, Shoei seems a little bit hurt there.
Yeah, two straight right hands, and the second one in particular did rock him.
He seems to have found his measure a little bit more than he had as Lewis. But Reese is very, very experienced, and he'll just buy in time, and he'll feint, he'll come out of range, he'll make it scrappy in there, which will eat away the seconds to keep him competitive in the fight.
It's another decent right hand there. Again, it's sometimes difficult to tell whether Taylor's been hurt by a shot or whether it is, like you say, just that unorthodox footwork.
Because he's so off balance, he's so unorthodox. See, because he's landed now and he's had a little bit of success, he's trying to jump on his man, but it's the wrong thing to do against Reese, because he'll just tie you up and he'll make it ugly in there. That's what Reese wants you to do. He wants you to overcommit. What Lewis needs to do is take a step back and again, I keep saying that word, measure his shots a little bit more. Mm. I would like to see him throw a 1-2 step back and then go for the third shot, so you don't overcommit.
Yeah, because if he stands
there, you go. See, you caught him there and then went too far away.
It's the danger of throwing the single shots, isn't it, that Taylor will see them all evening and he'll be happily moving around. It's been able to pressurise him and use the size and use the strength and weight advantage that you'll have.
I mean, this has been a much better round from Lewis, though. He's landing some telling shots in there today, in this round, sorry. Yep. Body shot there, though.
Yeah, a nice left hand to the body. And we'll just give Morris a little something to pause, something to think, realising, you know, there are shots coming back. As I say, there's a lot of experience.
For a small guy, Reese is quite strong. Like I said, I've sparred with him, and he doesn't mind the hustle and bustle in there. See, he's just trying to rough Lewis up here.
Yeah, a bit of professional work, I think they call that.
Yeah.
A couple of little left shots just on the hip.
And as well, it'll just frustrate Lewis. Because Lewis should feel that he should be touched in the air by this lad. He's fought probably more experienced lads.
It's a very different proposition, isn't there, going from being at a high amateur level, coming in against these experienced fighters. It's a very different sort of opponent.
And these guys that fight on the road, they're so experienced. They know how to eat away seconds in a fight. You know, when you feel like you've got them going, they'll just hold you, or they'll just bump you, or they'll use something just to slow down that charge. And stop you getting them out of there. I remember fighting a Russian at Warsaw Town Hall, and I thought I had him going every round, to a point that I blew myself out, so I was trying so hard to get him out of there.
And tonight we've got a couple of very, very experienced guys on the circuit, MJ Hall and Kevin McCauley. Kevin in particular has been around a long time and boxed in the hundreds of fights now, and they're there to give these prospects the rounds, the experience, and welcome them into the programme. Morris starts on a little bit lively, landing a couple of jabs. He's starting to get his range a bit more now.
See, Lewis started the last round really well as well, landing some really good right hands. But then as the round crept in, Shoei frustrated him again, closed that distance, and then started to make Lewis overcommit. I'm hoping that Lewis can sustain that long distance striking in this round and really see what Reese has left to offer, really. Because the early parts of the rounds, Lewis looks very good.
Yeah, it's a patient start from Lewis. Right hand over the top just misses and he gets tied up. This will be all good for Taylor. That's what he wants, to slow the action down.
See, what I'd like to see Lewis do there is, when Shoei does get there, try not to allow him to hold you. Just try and drop your legs, go a little bit lower with him, and start to bring the shots up and into the centre of the body. So if you notice, every time Lewis backs him up to the ropes, Lewis is still tall and Show is very low. So what I'd like Lewis to do is bend them knees slightly and start bringing them shots up and in the middle of the body.
Another right hand misses there from Morris. He's, well, he's probably winning the rounds. He's getting the best of the action. But he is being a bit frustrated in there at the moment, understandably so.
See, Reece would want this all day long.
Yeah, he's got to work in that clinch, hasn't he, Carl?
Yeah, this is what I'm trying to say.
He can't be allowed to be held.
But he's standing too tall. When you get inside, you have to drop your level. You have to lower those legs and dig in.
Taylor now looking quite comfortable, bouncing off the ropes, hands down by his side. Yeah. Is it looking quite fluid this evening?
A little bit of showmanship there, a little bit of play acting. Saying that you're not bothering me really, hands on the knees, showing confidence that I'm not afraid of what's coming at me.
As you say, this one's scheduled for four.
Reece has tried to push Lewis back this round now. He's held his feet a lot more.
Yeah, I do think you tend to find that some of these guys here that fight on the road will give it a couple of rounds, just get an assessment of what's in there, and then if they feel like they can have a go, they certainly will. A bit of a low blow there, though. Unintentional and an apology. Morris comes back with a good right hand. A little bit frustrated, possibly, from that shot.
I tell you what, Reece was really growing into that round there. Lewis has got to be careful that he doesn't get over-frustrated. He looked very frustrated towards the end of that round. He started the round very, very well. But towards the end of it, it was a pick-up round, really. I'd still give Lewis the round, but... He doesn't want to start the round the way he finished that one, does Lewis?
Now, to a lot of people watching at home, four rounds, that people that are used to seeing 10 and 12 round championship fights, it seems short, but I imagine when you're in there, especially on your debut, it's not a quick time. It's a long 12 minutes. Or different in your case?
I don't know, because I went from fighting at the world level in kickboxing that was doing 10 and 12 rounds. And there was only 10 twos or 12 twos, which was the short period over boxing, was their threes. So I went straight into professional boxing and had to drop down to four rounders. I felt like it was a sprint again. So, but these lads that are coming from the amateur scene who have done three twos, they're now stepping up to four threes. It is a longer period in there. So, yeah, you could say that it feels a lot longer in there. When you're making your debut.
Morris standing slightly low with that left hand again, just below the belt line on the hip.
See, this round, I'd really just like to see Lewis drop his level a little bit. He's still standing so tall above him. Just drop your level. Dip into your shots a little bit.
As you say, against the southpaw, the straight right hand's a weapon that you've got to be utilising, isn't it?
And I think the screw shot off the rear hand, off the back hand, he needs to be bringing that up and round. Faint with a jab, get Reece to dip down to that left hand side of his and bring that shot up and round as he dips. I'd even miss the jab and screw it up personally, because every time he throws that jab, if you notice, every time Lewis throws his jab, Reece drops down to his left hand side, which is just begging for a screw shot. That was a good right hand there though by Lewis.
Yeah, Lewis just trying to work out those angles. As you say, he's fighting very tall and he is struggling to make a catch there. He just misses with that uppercut.
But this is the perfect experience for Lewis. He'll learn so much from this fight. And this is why it's so vital to have people like Reece in the ring that give us this education. Because Lewis will look back on this and say, oh, I could have done this better in this moment. I could have done this moment. That was a good little spin. Spin right hand there though.
Yeah.
See, but over eager again.
Just as you
said. He landed such a good shot and then he tried to jump on his man. But again, this is all experience. This is a good learning curve for him here.
Just as you were saying that, Carl, so he landed that short left hand and he was just that little bit over eager, wasn't he? And the seconds ticking down on this one. So our first bout of the evening. Lewis Morris winning the rounds. but been there with a tricky customer and has been frustrated at times.
Yeah, I think Reece has done his has come to do what he wants to do today and get through the rounds, keep himself ready for the next fight, because these guys fight every week in, week out, as long as the work's there. So Reece will be happy with his performance. Lewis will be happy with his performance as well as his debut. He showed some really good stuff in there tonight. And listen, if you come out and come away from a fight and there's things that you can't work on.
Taylor with a little flashy combination as the seconds wind down.
Then you're not, as I say, if there's things that you come away from the fight and there's things that there's nothing to work on, then it's not a progressive fight, is it? So that was a good debut for Lewis. He'll walk away with that with four good rounds under his belt against a very tricky opponent. He did some good things in there tonight. Some things he can do better. I'm sure he'll be happy with his performance. And I think some credit has to go to Reece as well, because he made it tricky in there for Lewis tonight. So, yeah, well done to both of them.
So just awaiting the scorecard from the referee.
I would have scored that a 40-36 though. I don't think Lewis dropped a round in there.
Yeah, you occasionally get it where the refs seem to want to drop or score a shared round in these sort of bouts, but I think that was a fairly clear 40-36 fight.
Reece just kept himself in there. He didn't do enough to win rounds, but he did enough to keep himself in there and still posing a threat towards Lewis, still ask questions of Lewis. And that's what Lewis will want. And that's what his team will want.
So both men embraced, have a quick chat in the ring. A valuable lesson for Lewis, as you say.
...40-36 as I predicted.
Morris takes it, 40 points to 36.
And you know what though, the points don't really really tell the true reflection of the fight, because it was a lot more entertaining than that. Sometimes when you think a 40-36, you think a guy's just covered up and got through the rounds. But Reece did try and have a go there at times. So, a good bout overall. A good opener to this stacked card and this lively arena tonight.
As I say, the bouts will be coming thick and fast this evening. Should hopefully be joined soon by Lewis Morris. And he'll be speaking to BCB's Dan Moll.
Lewis, a punch perfect debut. How you feeling, mate?
Buzzing, to be fair, mate. So, I could have got him out there in the last and probably the second, to be fair, but I felt like I'd got to get rounds. I ain't boxed for 18 months, so I thought, just get in the rounds and see how I get on. Like, I'm buzzing with the performance, to be fair.
It's been a roller coaster week in some ways. Thought you was fighting at Warsaw. That gets postponed, but what a venue this is for your debut, mate.
Oh, mate, I'm buzzing. I've probably got more support in Wolves than what I have in Warsaw, to be fair. Boxing for Wolves and whatever. So the crowd that's come out tonight has been madness, buzzing, honestly.
And show he's a tricky character. He's obviously got that low level. He's difficult to hit.
Yeah, he's hard to hit. He gets really low. So like, I thought I had him hurt in the fourth round, and I tried to throw a right handle too, and I just go straight over top of him because he's high somewhat, and he's slick as well. So yeah, so he was tricky, but he was good.
Lovely. But a great start to the programme. Well done, Lewis.
Thank you. Thanks a lot. See you soon.
Back to you, Paul. We'll be right back.
So here we have Des Newton making his way to the ring, and he's fighting Ethan Collins. Is Ethan Collins' debut as well?
Yeah, I think it is it tonight, Ethan. So Des, we know from the shows that BCB down south, another very experienced fighter you'll have seen before.
He was a big ticket seller in Plymouth, right? Yeah, so
he did really well. He was going back a couple of years, but it's good to see he's still getting the work and still fighting.
I know he was a popular boy down Plymouth. I don't know how I'd find that, going from like the guy that sells all the tickets to the guy that goes against someone that's selling all the tickets. I don't know how I'd do that. I'm not sure. I mean, I fought abroad before where I've had no fans there, and that didn't bother me as such. But I mean, obviously he's not the favourite to win here tonight.
No, I think it's a great point, Carl. I remember seeing Max Maxwell fight a number of times, and Max, you know, I think he's won 20 of his first 24 fights and then lost the next sort of 20. It must be a mental thing. You have to kind of just accept that's your job, that's your role.
I mean,
and that's why not everyone can do it. And a lot of people think they could stick a pair of gloves on and work as a journeyman, but it takes a lot more than just
It's a skill. It's a skill in itself. Let's be honest, in my career now, what, I'm 14 and 11. I've had 11 good wins, but I've had three losses, and three losses against world level opponents, I must say. Cash Farouk, top two in the country and in the top 10 in the world, probably top 15. Charlie Evans, former world champion, and Baluta, who I boxed here last time. But you do have to question yourself and say, am I missing? Am I going to be able to make that step to that level? Although I still question that Baluta fight. Still, a lot of people still think I nicked it. But
an interesting scorecard. I was going to get on later on this evening, just talking obviously about yourself and plans. And obviously, you're very busy with the gym and everything that you're doing. And
that being said, as I'm going back to talking about Des, as we said about Maxwell, I don't know how the fighters cope with being the main man. I don't know how that would make myself feel as a fighter. I think Des just loves the game. I think that's what it's down to. He loves the game, and that's why he's still a part of it.
Yeah, and for staying in shape and getting well paid, and obviously so many of the guys will have boxed home frequently over the last couple of years for very obvious reasons. I think it's just people taking opportunities now, and as you say, getting up to turn some money on the road.
I mean, Errol Johnson for BCB Promotions has done really, really well keeping his fighters active throughout this pandemic. He's got opportunities for his fighters all on TV. So a lot of credit has to be given to Errol for the work he's done behind the scenes, getting his fighters fights, keeping his fighters. I mean, he has a massive stable of fighters, and he's kept them active. So.
Absolutely. After two warm-up shows, we're here with a larger event this evening. Just go over to the action in the ring again. Different style of fight to the first.
Yeah, Des is pushing Ethan back here. But Ethan's fighting quite well on the back foot here. But you can see that Des Newton's here to really make a go of this. He's pushing his man back and trying to impose his strength. Newton does look like the bigger man in there. Good overhand right there, though, by Collins.
Newton just looks physically bigger in there, doesn't he? But again, he's a man who can strafe a couple of different weight classes.
Collins didn't seem fazed, though. I must say, by Des coming forward, he's held his feet once or twice and pushed his man back, used his forearms to impose his own little bit of strength in there. But it's so draining when you've got a man that's so big and he's pushing you back. It can be quite draining. So Des does need, Ethan does need to get Des's respect at some point and just slow that pressure.
So Ethan making his second professional entrance this evening. He was boxed quite recently against Paul Cummings, another very experienced fighter.
Paul Cummings was in a good fight on Sunday at the Bestwick Stadium. I was there for that, and he boxed quite well. It was a draw. It's been quite an eventful opener. It's quite even. I would still say that Collins is nicking it. He's just done the tidier work, but the pressure's certainly there from Des Newton.
Yep, referee Sean Mess just giving a warning there for pushing and holding down.
I tell you what, having a telling off from that referee, you definitely know about it. I've had a few telling offs from him in my time in the ring. He gives you a really nasty look as he points in your face.
Yeah, you never see Sean Messer and Ross Kemp in the same place. Going back to the fight that he had here against Ionut Baluta, at the time he was someone who had a good record but was relatively unknown. I mean, obviously it was a very, very close fight, one that most people inside had you winning. But does it vindicate you a little bit with the go on and see what he achieved since? He had some fantastic wins and pushed Michael Conlon close.
Well, a lot of people think he beat Michael Conlon as well. I made a silly mistake at the beginning of that fight, and I believe that's what lost me the fight. I think sometimes when you get dropped, that the judges tend to not forget that. And I think that's what lost me the fight, if I'm honest. Even though that he had points deducted for spin at his gum shield, and he was hurt multiple times to the body in there. Listen. The guys that I have lost to, they don't disgrace my name at all. So it gives me confidence in that respect as well. How do you see this fight? How do you see this fight panning out?
Well, I think it's going to be interesting for Collins. As I say, he's in with him, a very experienced fighter. He started well. He's imposing his style, but again, these four rounds, they do seem to go so quick. And Newton certainly has come here to win rounds. It could be a lot closer than we think. Again,
have you noticed though, to start with this round, if you watch Des Newton come out in the first round, he pushed him back very fast. But this round, he started on the back foot a little bit, and it's actually Collins who's come out and pushed his man back.
Yeah.
So interesting tide change there.
Yeah, looking to hold the centre of the ring early. That must be a corner instruction in between the rounds.
But again, is Newton being smart, having a round off to put it on in the next two rounds? See, these guys that fight in the round on the road do that a lot as well. They'll allow you to become a little bit more confident in there to open you up. But I like the work that Collins is doing here. He's throwing some nice little flurries.
Yeah, he did well then, getting his shots off and then getting out, giving himself the distance.
His jab's been very good in this fight so far.
Nice left uppercut and a right hand to the body.
Yeah, he's starting to find his feet in there, is Collins.
Yeah, looking comfortable, and certainly Newton's output has slowed an awful lot this round. A couple of jabs missing.
He looks like he's enjoying himself in there, does Collins. He's definitely learning, but he looks like he's trying things as well, which is always good to see a fighter do. They're obviously working on things in the gym, and these are the opponents that you want to be doing it on.
A little bit of kinology there. Flexing his arms, saying that shot didn't land clean. But normally, I think, Carl, when a shot does land, that's when you do get the kinology, and that's when you do get the pretending.
I used to have this thing as a kid. When I'd get hit with a good shot, I'd stick my tongue out. And it was like almost slowly, like, yeah, you've got me, but I'm going to get you back. And this is what Des Newton's doing right now.
Yeah, Des with his hands by his sides.
He's trying to say you're not hurting him, but... I tell you what, if you look at Des Newton's left-hand side around the back, he's marking up really red. Just under that lat, so I think the body shots have been going heavy there.
Yeah, body shots on both sides there, nice little combination.
Oh, good 2-1-2 there.
Yeah. Good flurry of punches there from Collins.
I always like to see a fighter throw a backhand to the jab, then to the backhand again. That really shows confidence to me. A lot of fighters always stick behind that jab before allowing that backhand to go. You saw with Joshua last week. he wouldn't allow his backhand to go. So for a fighter to allow his backhand to go first usually shows that the guy's very confident. Yeah, Evans having a very good round this round.
Yeah, a good right hand there, and the crowd reacted to it. It was only a short shot, but it landed nice and clean. And a smile as he heads back to his corner, Carl.
Yeah, Collins is there, very happy with that round there. Now, I would be too. He boxed very nice. I'll tell you what, Des is a funny guy. Dancing around the ring.
Standing up between the rounds, which again, a lot of the journeymen seem to do. Again, no disrespect calling him that, a lot of the opponents seem to do. Very fresh legs, very fit. They do this every week. And he's having a good time in there.
See, Newton's in there to have a bit of fun now. He's just enjoying the end of his career. Collins, he's on the start of his career, isn't he?
The pressure's on Collins, isn't it?
Yes. So Newton's in there, he's having a bit of fun. He's enjoying his time in there. Where this is very much business for Ethan Collins at the moment. And I know that feeling. I've been in that position where this fight matters. Every fight that you're in there, every minute you're in there matters. Whereas for Dez, he can have a bit of fun. It doesn't matter if he loses a round here or there.
Yeah, Dez with a lot of upper body movement to start the round, and a little right hand over the top just misses. And then Collins comes out with a couple of jabs. It's easy, I think, as fights go on to forget the jab. You know, a lot of fighters start off early round one, round two, utilising it, and then it does seem to go. Is that a tiredness thing, Carl, or is that just sometimes a bit of a lack of discipline as fights go on?
I think sometimes tiredness can play a factor. I think that's one thing. I think frustration, and also you want to land that big shot to hurt your man. That can be another thing as well. I would say fatigue's the biggest one though. You just want to try and put a dent in your man. But have you noticed though, as I said last round, that Des Newton went on the back foot and took a little bit of time off. The start of the round, Newton come out quite fast, but now Collins is now pushing his man back and hurting him.
Yeah, Collins is really starting to put his shots together now, isn't he?
Very interesting. But Newton's having a go in there.
Yeah, Newton took that combination well, and he's playing up to the crowd. There's a lot of fans of Collins near this evening.
Again, another great learning fight for Collins here. Do you see how that man? Do you see how Dez is just resting here? This is so frustrating for a fighter that just wants to look good in there. And trust me, every prospect, you just always want to look good, and you're always worried about that critique. Oh, he got caught there though with a shot.
Yeah, Collins. He did.
But again, this is down to frustration. If he stuck to his boxing, these shots wouldn't land. And these are things that he'll look back on and say, you know what? They're the mistakes that I know I wouldn't make in a big fight. It's just down to frustration.
Yeah, little short left hand, and Newton throwing a couple of body shots. Just looking to try and slow Collins down a little bit, as he has started fairly quickly this round.
I tell you what though, Collins is looking a little bit tired here, and it's all down to Des Newton's pressure. He's really sustained a lot of pressure in this round. Lay on him, held him.
Yeah, Collins has landed a right hand.
Oh, good left hook there.
To take it.
That was a very good left hook, that was.
Yeah, Newton with a good left hand, he takes a step back and just measures the distance again.
Collins is looking a little bit tired in them, a little bit nervous for him.
Yeah.
He's looking a little bit wasteful with his shots. He was boxing so well in the first two rounds. He looked slick, he looked fast, but it just seems that Newton has actually, oh, he's caught him again, has just broke down that distance and now putting his man under pressure. Good uppercut again. Newton's really having a good end to that round there. Landed some good big shots.
Yeah, Newton slayed him down there at the end of that one. Big deep breath from Collins. He's getting a bit of a talking to in his corner there.
Listen, midway point in the fight, he's probably getting his second wind. I really expect Collins to come out and have a big round now. Yeah, especially with the telling off from his corner team. You know what, sometimes when you're coasting in the fight, sometimes you do kind of like, again, neglect your jab and just look a little bit big for your shots. So maybe that's all that he did. And sometimes when you get, it's like getting into a rut, isn't it? He's got into a little bit of a rut in that round. He needs to drag himself out this round and get back to his slick boxing. Get behind that jab, get behind his two ones, and move around the ring. Stop looking so big. Don't play into Newton's hands, because that's what Newton wants.
Yeah, fourth and final round of this one.
Newton really fancies this round now, though.
Yep. He's looking full of beans, Newton.
Yeah, he's straight on that front foot. Straight on that front foot. Let's see how Collins comes out. He's just had a 10 off from his corner. Let's see if he gets back behind that boxing, which I expect him to do. Good right hand there. Good. This is better. This is better by Ethan.
Yeah. Good little combination there from Collins. Again, Newton looking to
all that Ethan's going to do right here. That's a good jab. Very good jab. As we said at the end of the last round, he needs to get back behind that jab. Let his shots come off that jab.
Yeah, Collins keeping a slightly tighter guard as well in this round. Again, more likely instructions from that corner. Good uppercut.
Oh, see, this is better. See, he's back behind his boxing. He's not looking so big. He's looking to put his shots together. That's exactly what Ethan needed to do. So the corner team, this is where the corner team needs some credit for getting their man's head back into the fight. And now he's looking dangerous.
Much better work from Collins in this fourth round. Again, he's boxing off the back foot, but he's getting his shots in.
It's because he's not looking so big for his shots. He's not neglecting his boxing skills. He's got back behind his boxing rather than looking big. This is good round. Yeah. He's looking slick again.
Yeah, temporarily switching southpaw there just for a couple of seconds. And he's back in that orthodox stance with the high guard. A wild right hand missing there from Newton.
It's not an easy thing to do, and you see a lot of fighters these days try and switch a lot more.
Yeah, Newton coasting him in there with his hands by his side. And he's got to not take that bait, hasn't he, Carl?
No, because that's the frustration of Newton now. Newton's not getting the round that he wanted, and with the round that he had last, he expected Collins to come out the same way. Collins has got back behind his boxing, so now Newton's feeling frustrated. So this should be a big confidence booster for Ethan Collins, knowing that he's frustrating his man again by getting back behind his boxing. Good work.
Yeah, he's just leaning on him there again, just ticking those seconds away. Again, a great experience fight here for Ethan Collins. And jab just misses inside. Both men exchanging jabs.
Again, an entertaining fight though.
Yeah, good little combination there. Again, Newton takes those punches well. He throws a big right hand and left and right of his own.
I tell you what, Newton's a tough man, isn't he? Let's be honest.
Yeah, very tough. And his punches, they look like they're still going to be a sting to them.
Oh, good shot there, overhand right.
Yeah, another right hand. And Collins, with that again, that's almost switch it in style, but he's finding himself getting caught too square
see,
on there,
see, Carl. See. This is where Newton has really pressed the pace again, and now Collins is feeling it. So I would say, if I could give any advice to Collins, he needs to work on his fitness going forward. Because when he steps up them rounds and he gets some tougher opponents, he might struggle. Yeah, against someone that can impose their strength on you. That would be my own criticism. I think that's the only thing that let Collins down tonight, that was that at times the pressure from Newton, where you have to give credit to Newton for that, zapped his energy a little bit. So again, this is why you have these learning fights.
Should might be a good win there for Collins. So just awaiting the scorecards, plenty of experience, and he gives a kiss to someone inside. Good amount of supporters in there for someone fighting so frequently. Just await referee Sean Messer's card.
Newton's definitely a character.
He's had a good time in there, he's earned a few quid, and he certainly hasn't disgraced himself over those four rounds.
Yes, bro.
I didn't hear the scorecard. What was the scorecard?
Yeah, I didn't quite get that myself. It was slightly muffled on the microphone, but Ethan Collins is the winner.
He, he was the deserved winner, of course. I'm just very impressed with Newton's pressure that made Collins learn something in there today.
So Dan will be catching up with Ethan Collins very shortly.
Packed house in here tonight.
And from early as well, which I always like to see. Sometimes at these shows, fighters, they come, but the fans, they come to see their fighter and then they up and go. But there's so much good action, it's well worth sticking around for.
Ethan, fantastic performance against a real character in Des Newton. How did you find that?
It's all right. It was a good performance. In and out, nice. Tucked up nicely, so it was all right. And he's as tough as they come. I wouldn't say as tough as the last one. He was just sort of easing through it. Last fight, I started a bit too quick, but now settled into it. Just soaking up the atmosphere, just enjoying it, because it's an early one. It's still early in the career, so yeah, just... Nice performance.
It's been a nice couple of weeks for you as well, hasn't it? Turning professional and two fights in 3 weeks. Is that the aim, to stay busy?
Well, it was for now, because I turned back in 2019 and I was meant to be on the first show back at Dudley Town Hall, which would have been full, just like this is now, and it would have been a nice show, but obviously COVID come around. And COVID come around and sort of laid everyone off for 18 months. So I've sort of been pro 3 years with just two fights. So when you say it that way, it's not quite good. So it's good to get out. I'll probably have a few weeks off now, taper down a bit, and then get back straight to it. Hopefully getting one before the end of the year.
Ethan, great fight. Well done. Congratulations on the win. Back to you.
Welcome back. The next fight we have is Ollie Cooper in with Kevin McCauley. Anybody that's been to any boxing show in the last, I won't say how many years, and disgrace Kevin, but a good number of years will have seen Mr.
And you know
McCauley
what?
Box.
And I love that he's coming out to this song. This is one of my favourites. What boxing fan does not love this song?
Yeah, he's here to win the crowd over, no doubt, Kevin. Hugely experienced guy, been in there with anyone and anyone, Frankie Gavin, many other fighters.
He's been in with Danny Ball as well. Yeah. And Danny Ball is fighting for the British title soon up in Birmingham.
The opposite ends this evening. Ollie Cooper making his walk to the ring for the very first time. Kevin McCauley in his 241st bout. Don't know if he'll keep going to get up to that 300 that Peter Buckley managed. It's an incredible achievement, Carl. 241 fights.
Yeah, he's a very popular lad. I mean, one of my dads that actually helped me at my gym, he's come to watch him tonight, and I think he works with him. And he only speaks good things about Ollie Cooper. He says that he's a great, down-to-earth lad, but he's got a very promising career ahead of him. Again, under the guidance of Richie Carter from Wolverhampton Boxing, a very extensive amateur pedigree as well. So, But again, he's in there with one of the toughest guys in professional boxing, and that's Kev McCauley. I've seen this guy time in, time out, and he always brings a show. He always brings a fight.
That he certainly does. And it's safe to say a stoppage is very, very unlikely to be on the cards here from Cooper.
The only time I've ever seen Kev McCauley start, and that was against Danny Ball at Worcester Town Hall, and that was a massive shot. But that's why you know that Danny Ball is going a long way. Because not many guys get, as you said, he's been there with Frankie Gavin, he's been in there with some of the toughest guys, yeah. Well, the best guys in the division, in the divisions. And Kevin McCauley goes through the gear, well, through the weights, I should say.
He does, certainly fighting anywhere from lightweight, like welter, and above.
So I'd be very interested to see how Ollie starts out this first round.
Ollie Cooper.
Oh! Got caught straight away with that left hook. Standing a bit tall. Allowed Kev just to sneak in and catch him with that left hook.
Well, that's certainly a wake-up call for Cooper. Yeah. Ollie Cooper standing in the southpaw stance. Kevin McCauley in the white shorts. Cooper in the sort of dark brown with the orange lettering. But that was a wake-up call inside the first 10 seconds.
It was a little bit too relaxed, is what it was. I don't even think it was a mistake. I think he's got in there a bit too relaxed.
McCauley popped a little left hand and intimates the referee the shot was there slightly behind the head from Cooper in return.
He's very big, isn't he, Ollie? Very tall lad.
Yeah, certainly looks tall for the weight. Nice little right hand to the body there, which
he looks like he's got all the skills. You can see he's got a very good amateur pedigree behind him. You can see he's been boxing a long time because you can see he's got that little bit of sass in there.
Yeah, and you'll know yourself, Carl, a lot of it isn't people watching what they're doing with the hands, it's watching the feet.
Yeah, and that's what I've noticed so far. The way he's posturing, that was a good left hand down the centre there. I want to make a prediction. I want to say that Collins, that Ollie Cooper's going to get him out of there. And I don't usually go against Kev McCauley.
That's a big call out against a man of McCauley's experience. Let's see how this one.
I think his sharpness will be telling. He looks very sharp in there.
And again, he's showing more patience with his shots than what we've seen from earlier in the evening.
Yeah, he's not falling. And this is why I think he might be able to get him out of there, because he's so measured. See just how he glides out of range. Kev tried to close the distance there to try and probably hold him. Ollie Cooper just glided out and kept him on the end of his shots.
McCauley has right hand that goes straight through.
And I think sometimes when you fought at such a high level in the amateurs and you're coming against these guys that have had so many losses on their record, sometimes you can think, oh, they're not going to pose any threat to me. And you can go in there a little bit relaxed. And I think that's what happened with the opening shot from Kev McCauley. Ollie went in there a little bit overconfident that this guy's got nothing that can faze me. And, yeah, but he's learned from that straight away.
Cooper with the left hand, but McCauley rode it well into the ropes. Again, that's just all about experience, isn't it? Taking the shot and taking the pressure off that punch.
So Cooper's putting nothing behind these shots. He's just playing with him, really, which is good to see.
Not wasting energy, isn't it? That's a big part of it.
Yeah. He looks, see, that was a good left hand there, stern, but not over committing with his shots, which is good to see. He looks like he's a pro fighter that's had a couple of fights already, because he's not rushing his work, he looks very patient, he looks very calm. Good round.
Apart from those first few seconds, it was very, very clearly an Ollie Cooper round. So for those watching on Facebook and on YouTube, please like and share the page. BCB Boxing is where we share all our live events as well as interviews. And also a quick plug for the BCB podcast, which is available on Spotify, Amazon, TuneIn, anywhere else you get your podcast from, where we have interviews with a lot of the BCB stable, and also big fight previews and reviews of not just BCB, the whole world of boxing we like to try and cover.
Oh, good left hand there.
Yeah, nice straight left hand. Again, McCauley looking a little bit small in there. He's not really popping that jab out. He seems it's a cautious start for him to the second.
Yeah, round. And McCauley usually will have a go, but he looks like he's just going to cover up here and try and get through the rounds. But the main thing is that Ollie doesn't get over eager by that. I mean, keeps doing what he's doing. Just keep picking your shots. Break your man down slowly. And that's all about experience.
Cooper with that sort of quite nice, loose sort of languid style that he's got. Visually not of the same calibre, is not what I'm saying, but along the lines of a Luke Campbell type, you know.
Blender. Will he carry the power in the division?
Little combination there from Cooper inside. Patient work from the young man. And the pace is slowing down a little bit in this round. McCauley just keeping that nice tight guard, offering him very little in return, just looking to bob and move.
It's good to have so many Wolverhampton lads on a Wolverhampton show. You know what I mean? And the amount of times that I've fought in Warsaw or Birmingham just to get on a show, it's good that Errol Johnson has brought boxing back to Wolverhampton. We've been crying out for a venue since Civic shut down many years ago, because that was the home of
it's
of
a
the
great
boxing.
Venue as well.
Great
Civic,
venue,
wasn't it? Yeah, really.
I
really
never had the opportunity to fight there, and it's maybe that's what everyone needs to do. Needs to get the Civic back open for me to come back. I don't know. The bucket list. That's a great left hand there. I'm really impressed with Cooper's management of this fight. He hasn't been caught with anything. He's not over eager. He's just picking his shots, breaking down his man slowly. This is a very mature performance in what is his debut, right?
Yeah, absolutely, Carl. In his professional debut, it's.
And you know what? You see the some of the lads that have had the most amateur fights come into their pro debut and not perform like this because they want to put on a show, but. Ollie seems like he's got a very mature head on his shoulders in there. He's boxing with patience. He's so efficient. It's good to see. Maybe some promising things coming from Cooper down the line.
That's right, we're heading into the third round of this one. Still to come this evening, Kirsty Babington, after that fight against Sandy Ryan, that huge fight, that big exposure. He's in with Becky Ferguson over 6 2-minute rounds. Jermaine Osborne Edwards, very well known, very popular lad in the area, is in with a very experienced MJ Hall. And Alex Round takes on Kieran Thomas. With the main event, Conor Walker against that late replacement, the unbeaten Jack Eubank over 6, still to come this evening.
I still think that top of the bill is a tougher fight than what it was in the Midland area title fight, personally.
Because I think Jamie Stewart, you know, a good fighter, you know, got that draw with Florian Marku, but he's had those couple of losses, and I think he very much knew he was coming in as the opponent, and I don't think that.
He's very tall, is Cooper. Very, very tall.
Yeah, you can see McCauley struggling a little bit to get those, you know, the headshots in his knee. He's probably going to spend most of the fight focusing more.
Again, this is the only thing that he needs to probably work on. That's different from the program to the amateurs. You don't get guys that duck and come underneath you and come up over the top of you. You get guys that stand tall with you and box long. That's when I coach my amateurs, that's what we work on. Box long, box and move, long shots. Because that's pretty much what the amateur game is. But when you go into the pro game, you get guys that dip low on their knees and swing shots from all different weird angles. And that's the difference from the pro game to the amateurs. That the amateurs are very. It's almost very, very straight. It's like fencing. I always say to my kids, it's like fencing, right? So when you come to the pro game, the shots coming from all different angles.
Again, Cooper landing nice shots, but very little behind them, and Kevin complaining of a shot behind the head there. Again, Cooper got his hands by his sides. He seems very comfortable in there, but you mentioned about the power earlier. He certainly doesn't look like he's putting much dig onto the shots at the moment.
Is it a case that he's not letting his power go, though, and he's just trying to bank those rounds? It could be that, because he doesn't look like he's actually committing with his shots. He's just, to be fair, he looks like he's playing with McCauley in there. But that is a question that needs to be had, that needs to be answered, I think. But again, this is his pro debut, so maybe he just wants the rounds. I mean, he would have got, as a senior, he'd have gone from three threes, wouldn't he, in the amateurs. You fight in the seniors, you fight three minute rounds. So he's doing one round more.
Yeah, nice stuff here as the round ticks away. Good little combinations, head to body.
To be honest, this is more of a typical 40-36, and the fights before this haven't been typical 40-36s, but this has. When I was saying in the last two fights that when you hear a 40-36, you think, oh, he was not entertaining, there's one guy that covered up. But in this fight, that's the way it has gone.
Yeah, again, a couple of shots look like they come through the guard there, but very comfortable for McCauley. Another round in the bank for Cooper.
So what I would like to see happen now, is I would like to see Ollie Cooper go through the gears now and try and get his man out of there. He's got his three rounds in there. He's tried some stuff out. Now try and close the show. That's what, get people excited about you. Sometimes when you go to these 40-36 and you just box the man around the ring, listen, it's a brutal sport. People want to see brutality. So I'm not saying that.
What you want to be entertained, don't you? And that's it. You want people to come back and buy a ticket.
So look, the crowd's gone quite flat in this fight.
Yeah.
Yeah. And in the previous two, because there was a little bit of back and forth from the opponents, the crowd got behind it. It's gone a little bit flat in here. So I'd like to see Ollie Cooper go through the gears now and really try and push his man out of there.
Well, I think Ollie, to be fair, did just signal to the crowd a little bit to spur him on and get him going.
So yeah, I really want to see Ollie push the gears now and try and get him out of there. Let them fast stinging shots go and whip it to the body. See if you can get them the hands to lower and then go back upstairs. That's what my advice to my man in the corner would be. Fast flurry shots upstairs, drop it downstairs and then go back up.
Yep, and he's only got a couple more minutes to go, so it's about putting, like I say, putting a little more into those punches.
Yeah, sit down on them legs a little bit.
Better work, certainly. And again, he's trying to feel a little bit of noise out of the crowd. So it has gone a little bit quieter. And you can see he's trying to, with a little bit of motivation from outside.
Listen, he knows there's nothing coming back. So let your hands go. That's my advice. I'd be screaming at him in the corner, let your hands go. Now, I'm not saying to get reckless and be dangerous in there, but let your hands go and try and get your man out of there.
Left hand through, but McCauley just holding that really, really tight guard. His elbow's nice and tucked down by his side as well, giving very, very few opportunities.
This is why Ollie Cooper needs to go upstairs, drop a little sneaky one downstairs, and then finish heavy and sit down on that last shot to the head to see if you can wobble the man.
And then Cooper hands by his side, pops a little jab out, just catches McCauley. And again, a couple of shots, that's him up against the ropes. Again, McCauley using the ropes to take some of that power away, and showing that huge experience that he has.
Listen, and let's give some credit to McCauley, because McCauley knows how to survive and get through the rounds. He knows how to tuck up, cover up, and get through the rounds. Listen, he needs to work week in, week out. So, you know, although he's in there with a very experienced lad, don't take the experience away from Kevin McCauley as well, who's seen types of this opponent time and time and time again.
Yep, certainly week in, week out, he'll be in with lots of, as you say, high quality guys. And as I say, after a quicker start, the pace slowing slightly, a little left hand to the body got through there. The seconds are ticking away again, Kyle, and it's...
I mean, how many pro fights now has Kevin McCauley had?
I think it was his 241st, I think it was
Listen, he's a warrior, isn't he? Yeah. And the game doesn't progress without people like him.
I think if it wasn't for COVID, he'd have had another 30 odd fights on top of that at least. And he's still got plenty in the tank. I haven't spoken to him recently. I don't know how many more years he's planning on going. But
he literally is that type of guy that has gloves, will travel. That literally is Kevin McCauley. Has gloves, will travel.
Yeah, Cooper trying to beckon him on there a little bit, but he's not going to fall for that, is he?
That's the frustrating thing when you're going against a journeyman. Good performance, good debut opening, showed some promising things there. Just lacked a little bit of excitement from him. But some promising things from him to come.
Yeah, very fair assessment that one, I think, Carl. Ollie Cooper will get the points verdict. He will learn a lot from there, and I imagine we'll see him back in the ring very soon.
Well, at my previous point, what I was saying was that when you come against these guys that fight on the road, when you fight against these guys that are on the road and they're just took up and they don't give you anything, you can't get the guys out of there because they're so tight. And you'll see knockouts more down the road because he's that slick boxer.
It's when you're up against guys who are not trying to hit you back, but they've got more motivation, aren't they? And like you said, that's when you do.
Yeah, they're opening up. They're opening up because they're trying to be on the front foot as well. And with a guy like Kevin McCauley, who's content to sit on the back foot, there's not many gaps. There's not many gaps to create that opening to get them out of there. And I truly believe as Ollie goes through his career, and the guys that have a little bit more ambition than Kevin McCauley did tonight, you might see a different style of fighter. But great opening debut. Not classy. There's a lot of things to build on in there.
Dan will be catching up with Ollie Cooper very shortly, so we can talk him through that experience. As I say, we've got still four fights to go this evening. Still plenty of action for everyone watching on Facebook and YouTube.
Ollie, congratulations, debut out the way, winning start, punch perfect as well, 40-36, you must be delighted.
Spot on, mate, yeah, exactly what I expected. I think I'm always hard on myself, but yeah, I think there's things to work on and stuff like that, but no, as a debut, impressive it really.
How big a box is that to tick then to get that pro debut out the way?
Oh, huge, mate, huge, especially against someone like Kev, you know what I mean, veteran of the game. To do 4-3s with him for my first one, spot on, mate, yeah.
You kept a guy like you're saying, Kev McCauley, pretty quiet tonight, and not everybody's able to do that.
Yeah, well, I think definitely my style that helped me tonight, nice and sleek, long range, you know what I mean, 6'4". Not many people can get near me, not in the gym, not in the ring, so I think that helped me tonight, so yeah.
And what a wonderful place, what a wonderful venue to make your debut.
Brilliant, mate, absolutely brilliant, it's buzzing in here. I didn't think it would be, I didn't expect this sort of turnout, but looking at it now, what a venue and what a turnout we've had tonight, so it's really good.
So what's next for Ollie Cooper?
Errol mentioned the show potentially in December, here again. Maybe back in the gym, have a rest next week, back in the gym and training hard just for that phone to ring and then go again.
Ollie, congratulations tonight, well done. Top man.
Yeah.
back live with our next bout of the evening. One and only female bout, which sees Kirsty Bavington take on Becky Ferguson. Kirsty Bavington, a PE teacher from Wolverhampton, also used to play for Wolverhampton Football Club. Again, was last out against Sandy Ryan, who will very likely go on and become a world champion. Sandy Ryan, a real class act. And Kirsty certainly didn't disgrace herself.
Yeah, she made it very rugged on that Sky performance. Well, the zone performance, I should say. And she really asked a lot of questions of her opponent. So looking to get back to winning ways today.
As we say, kind of a local fighter, you know, certainly very well known and popular in the city. And so over that 6 2-minute rounds, all female fights take place over 2 minutes. It's a big topic of discussion that, as to whether they should step up to the threes. I understand that, but I always think it makes a slightly different dynamic to the sport. It makes it slightly different, a lot more fast-paced. You know, they've got to get all their action early.
It's very exciting. I tell you what, one of our own, Rachel Ball, I mean, she's been in some cracking fights, some absolute cracking fights, and I think the 2 minutes, it actually makes the fights better.
Yeah, and I think it's safe to say, you know, 5 6 years ago, we had very, very little women's boxing anywhere in the UK. The likes of Katie Taylor, others have really changed the sport, and now they're everywhere.
Yeah, I tell you what, I've noticed personally myself that, in my club that I run myself, that I've got a lot more females participating in boxing and looking to get involved in the sport. I think sometimes, when it's not put out there on the television, it's not there on the social media. I think Eddie Hearn must take a lot of credit for building Katie Taylor's reputation and making women's boxing grow, especially in the UK.
It's having role models, isn't it? You know, if they haven't got anything they can kind of look to and think, what could I possibly become? But now they all have your Rachel Balls, your Katie Taylor.
Sure, I mean, Lou DiBella, I know he does a lot in America with the girls.
Yeah, that's right.
But I mean, Eddie Hearn does deserve a lot of credit for putting the women's boxing up there and giving them the credit that they deserve.
Yeah, Bavington gets through early with a nice right hand and just warned for a low punch there, referee Sean Messer. Yeah, they're getting right to it, certainly action wise. It's a big step up from the previous fight.
Oh, she looked like she had a hurt there.
Yeah.
Both girls look like they've come here to fight, though. Kirsty's a tough girl as well.
As we touched on, very, very sporty Kirsty as a PE teacher. And another nice little
good jab there.
Yeah, good jab. Spits the guard.
I'd like her to settle down and let that shot do a bit more work. So I feel like the only time that Kirsty's going to get caught is when she's trying too hard to get a girl out of there. Kirsty can box. I've seen her do it. She can fight too, don't get me wrong, and that's probably her strongest point. But she can box. So sometimes I'd like her not to neglect that boxing ability that she does have.
Yeah, which is something, and again, it's an unfair thing because of how good Sandy Ryan is, but somewhere she's finding herself getting caught quite square on against Ryan.
Yeah, but
and that was her undoing.
Yeah, but you're talking a girl that's had how many amateur fights?
Yeah, hugely experienced. Yeah,
and Kirsty didn't have that. So, again, she didn't disgrace herself at all. She made a good fight out of it, if anything, and asked questions of Sandy Ryan. I would like her to give herself a bit more credit in there tonight and let her boxing skill show. Yes, of course she can fight, she can rough it out. But give yourself a bit of credit on the boxing side of things too.
I've been tying up close as that first round flies by.
I'll tell you what, being down in BCB, obviously Errol's pushed a lot. He has got a lot of ladies under him now. He had Danny Hodges, he's got Rachel Ball, obviously got Kirsty Bavington.
Amy Timlin for us for a time, who's moved on into being involved in big fights.
And I saw some of these spar each other, and there were some really good spars. Really, really good spars.
So Errol and Paul Mann both work in the corner of Kirsty Valentin tonight. His dual role as promoter and trainer. Second round of this one, scheduled 4-6. Both again coming out very quick to start the round. And the referee may have his work cut out a little bit here. It's been a bit rough. And giving him the opportunity to box out, and Kirsty coming through with a good right hand there. A lot of work coming from Ferguson, but not a lot of clean shots landing.
Again, entertaining fight though. Because they're trying to do so much work in that 2 minutes, and trust me, they push as hard as I know Kirsty does. She trains so hard. Like she really works hard in the gym. She works harder than some of the men that are fighting 12 threes, and she's fighting a 4 or 6 threes round, and she pushes just as hard. Trust me.
Yeah, Barrington looking for that right hand to the body again. A good shot to look for against the southpaw. She's landed it a couple of times already. A bit more measured from her there with that left hook upstairs.
She's only recently see that jab there again. Yeah. This is what I'm trying to say. Don't crowd your work, Barrington. Let your jab go and rely on your boxing skills as well. I think sometimes she's not been given the credit to do that.
Yeah, she gave herself some good space to land some individual shots, and then she's doing the work inside now. Growing in confidence as this goes on, Barrington.
Pull that jab out more, I'd like to see from her. Double that jab up.
Just as you say that, she looked for the jab over the top. But again, this is where she's a little bit rough, where she's catching herself square on, throwing left and right hands. But I think she feels like she's quite confident that
this is where she's at home. It's where she's at home. It's where she feels safe. It's where she likes to be. But to progress, she has to do the things that she doesn't like to do. That was a good door 1-2 there.
Yeah, good right hand. Just comes up a little bit short with the uppercut. Ferguson senses that.
Good body shot.
A little bit, and she starts to throw back herself.
Very good round of action there.
Asking when Kieran's fighting. Kieran Thomas will be on a little bit later after Jermaine Osborne takes on MJ Hall. And Kieran will be in with Alex Round in the penultimate fight of the evening.
Good right hand to start the round there by Barrington. She's using her feet quite well here, bouncing in and out of range. I just don't want her to stick her feet and feel like she has to go into the trenches all the time. Let your boxing do the work.
You can definitely hear the coaching call this evening, as I say, is the frustration and the passion. He's trying to get that point across, and it's wanting her. You know what she's capable of doing and what she needs to be doing. So often it's hard to get to implement that in the ring. Babington looking to hold the centre of the ring a bit more. A slightly more conventional guard now, keeping that right hand nice and tucked under the chin.
Good jab there. Good jab. Good jab back hand over the top. Good shot again. Good girl.
Yeah, right hand snaps Ferguson back. Again, very durable Ferguson. Both of them fighting up so close, Carl.
I'm very animated as a coach as well as a fighter, so Sometimes I get too overzealous on what I'm saying. He's just passionate about the game. That's all it is. I coach my own fighters, and sometimes I feel like just pulling them out and saying, "I'll do it for you," because you're not doing what I want you to do. It's hard when you fight yourself and you coach. It's hard.
Ferguson with a little bit of success there. Yeah, she did indeed.
And that just reminds Kirsten that she can't get careless and reckless in there. But like I says, Kirsten loves to be in these kind of fights. She loves a war.
Yeah, both fighting up close. Another round flies by. Probably Ferguson's best round of the fight, but you can imagine these rounds are certainly going to Ballington.
Just taking a look at it, I always take a look at the fighters when they walk back to the corners and how they're responding to information in the corners. You can see that Curtis's opponent, Becky, she's Becky Ferguson, he's like gasping for air. Is she really taking the information? You can see that Babington, he's sat up, she's taking information, she's very alert. That's always a telling sign for me. Personally.
She's looking right forward, isn't she, Ferguson?
Yes.
She's a little bit distracted, certainly. Yeah, she's gasping for air.
Her mouth's open, she's like, yeah. I'd like Babington to get on her feet this round. Maybe try and go on the back foot a little bit and try and pick her girl off. Make her other girl come in. Oh, that was a good start, though, for my Ferguson.
Yeah, Ferguson came flying off a stool.
But so did Babington, answered it straight away with an overhand right. There's just not a lot of room in there, is there?
No.
They're overcrowding each other a little bit.
And it's certainly not a small ring either. They really, you know, they can use the space, but Babington's maybe been drawn into fighting that kind of post box type fight, a phone box fight, should I say.
Good little manoeuvre there. She spun around, brought the uppercut up. And I saw Errol Johnson telling her that he wants to see more uppercuts. In the corner, as I was watching the corners, Errol Johnson did say, bring that uppercut up a lot more. So straight away, she's tried to impose in what her corner is saying.
Yeah, she's holding a little bit while she's hitting there. I'm surprised the referee hasn't.
Especially for Sean Messer, because he doesn't usually take any messing around. Excuse the pun, Messer for no messing. Oh!
Big left hand from Ferguson.
Good shot. You know what? Babington was just walking back, not in shape, and got caught with a silly shot there.
Yeah, and Babington lands a right hand back in return, but that was just a shot just to let her know that she's certainly still there. Both exchanging big punches. Ferguson does look tired though, Kyle.
Yeah, and as I said, as I watched her walk back to her corner, I noticed that. But she's still dangerous, she's still in there, she's keeping herself just ticking along. Babington's winning these rounds, not easily, don't get me wrong. Yeah. These are not easy rounds for Babington in there.
Babington walked onto her right hand there, as you say, if you're going to stand in front of your opponent, you're going to hold that centre of the ring, you have to be the one that punches first, don't you?
Neither girl have moved their head very well. Listen, when you plant your feet, you have to move your head a little bit more. You can't just stand directly in front. So what I feel they're doing at the moment is they're just clashing constantly.
Yeah.
And it's making it a very messy affair, to be honest. Because of the timing of the rounds, because there's only 2 minutes a round, sometimes they do overrush their work. But if you look at the likes of Katie Taylor, they fight over the longer rounds, right? There's that bit more of head movement, there's that bit more footwork involved. They'll take their little walk around the ring, they'll give themselves a little bit of space to have a look at their opponent. In these little 4 and 6 rounders, they're just trying to, it's almost like a grab and smash. A smash and grab is what I'm trying to say, right? They're just trying to smash and grab the win. I would like just a little bit more patience from Babington. I think it'd make her look a little bit more classy in there.
Yeah, Errol slightly animated in the corner there. When Babington returned to the stall, she did a big blow, but it wasn't a tiredness. I think it was a frustration herself.
Yeah. Good right hand to start the round. Little spin off right hand there. I tell you what, I've been told off by Errol a few times. Last time I was here, he gave me a slap. He's a very animated coach himself.
Yep, certainly does his work in the background, Errol. You won't get him in front of the cameras, but he hugely, hugely experienced. Determined to get him on the podcast. The request has gone in, so if we can get the pressure on.
I'll tell you now, it will never happen. Maybe one behind the scenes where he's not seen, maybe. You don't see him, maybe, but no. Errol's not a big talker. But when he says something, he means it.
Yeah. Again, some tide punches there from both girls.
Yeah, that
has got a little bit sloppy.
Yeah, they're looking a little bit reckless in there. They're looking a little bit tired. Yeah, they just need to clean it up a little bit. Take the workload down, and place a little bit more quality behind their work.
Yeah, decent left hand there from Ferguson, but again, quite slow pace, not a lot of power behind it.
They're just overcrowding each other. There's no space in there whatsoever. And to be honest, it's spoiling the fight. Oh, that was a good shot. As Bavington looked to load up her right hand, Ferguson just caught with a short right.
That right's been there, hasn't it, for this evening? She seldom used it, but when it has landed, there has been it's a decent punch for her. That little short right hand out the southpaw. Okay, it's pace slowing a little bit, but again, that little right hand, Bavington though, comes back with a decent right hand back.
There is them little reminder shots in there, isn't there? From both girls have landed them little reminder shots to let their opponent know that they're still in there and they're still fighting. If you look at Ferguson though, she slumps over the ropes as soon as she goes back to the corner. She's struggling there. She's not finding this easy. Bavington still looks fresh, to be fair. But that being said, every time Ferguson's come out, she's gave a good account of herself in every round.
You tend to get the feeling that the fitness certainly and the higher quality work is coming from Bavington, but Ferguson maybe has a slight edge in terms of power. That little right hand, as I say, it's just not been utilised enough, Carl.
No, Ferguson's landed, every time she's landed it, it's been a very good shot, but she hasn't landed enough of them to take advantage in this fight.
Yeah, she's certainly not winning any rounds, she's having her moments, but all the rounds are going to Bavington.
Bavington's winning this fight by pressure alone. She just out-pressured her girl.
Sixth and final round here. As I say, we've still got two more fights to go before our main event.
Good little flurry in there from Bavington.
Right hand over the top from Bavington. She works her way to the body.
She's like she's in the trenches, isn't she? She just trenches along. She's in there throwing punch for punch.
Both really going for it now. Again,
to be fair, I'm quite impressed with their toughness in there. They've really not took a step. Neither girl has took a step back. Even though there's been telling shots landed, neither girl has stepped back and kind of covered up. They've still tried to fight fire with fire, which is so good to see.
Yeah, and Ferguson actually fighting quite a smart fight now, you know, really sort of taking the pace out of it a little bit. As you say, she was gasping for air at the end of round four and five, and she certainly cruised through the first minute. Sloppy inside, Ferguson just holding that side of Bavington's head.
Yeah, it's just
seconds ticking away now.
Yeah, it's just been messy. They've kind of spoiled the fight in certain respects for each other by holding and just. But that's just both girls trying to be very willing to get on the front foot and take advantage of the fight, I would say. Good little shot there by Bavington with an uppercut.
There from her, but nothing really landing from. And Babette sees the end of those six rounds. Both girls embrace a decent encounter. The pace certainly slowed as it went on. Bavington looks a frustrated figure in the corner there, Kyle, but yeah, certainly she'll have got the win.
yeah, she definitely won that fight, but she probably wants a more convincing win. She probably wants her looking a little bit better than that. Obviously, she's just been with a girl called Sandy Ryan, who's fought at a very high level. Kirsty will see this as a step down for her.
Yeah.
And Kirsty wants to be on the level of the Sandy Ryans. That every fighter does, every fighter wants to fight at the highest level. So that's probably where Kirsty's frustration is there. She's walking back to the corner, probably thinking that she could have been a bit cuter in there, a little bit tidier. So, but listen, she got the win, and that's the most important thing. You go back to the drawing board, and you work on the things that happened in the fight, and that's it. Listen, people don't remember in a long list of your fights, they don't remember each and every individual performance. They remember how many you won and how many you lost. So that's another win on her belt. Now she needs a big performance in her next fight.
Yeah, Babington takes it, 60 points to 55, I think that was. Fair play to Ferguson. I think that was only her second professional fight, going in from the debut into going in with a girl as tough as Kirsty.
To be fair, it could, listen, other people might have said it could have been a lot closer than that. People could say that. I do think the result was correct and Babington won. But Ferguson deserves a little bit more. A little bit more from that, I feel.
Yeah, difficult, isn't it? A share of one round and nothing from the rest. So Kirsty celebrates there in the ring with a trainer, Paul Mann. And Dan will be catching up with her shortly. More and more people joining on the live stream, so thank you for that. Most people on the comments saying, well, a couple of thinking that they thought that Becky had won. I wouldn't go that far, Carl, but it was competitive, wasn't it?
Listen, that's it. I can understand why people will say that it was a closer fight. I still think that Babington won. She pushed the pace for most of the fight. Ferguson did land some telling shots, some eye-catching shots. And sometimes, as when you're watching at home, you remember them eye-catching shots, right, rather than the actual workload that's being put out there. And Babington, for me, outworked the other girl, right? And that's what won her the fight. Yes, there was some eye-catching shots from Ferguson as Babington was trying to push the pace, but no, for me, the person that won the fight was the right winner.
Absolutely. Kirsty is just going to be joining us very shortly. I'm speaking to Dan Moll.
Kirsty, congratulations against a real unknown opponent. How do you feel?
I feel good. I wanted to win, man. I feel positive from Eos. Maybe wanted to stop her. But yeah, I did the best I could, so got the win. So that's all I wanted, to move on, move forward.
Especially against somebody who nobody knows anything about, making a debut, on the road, an absolute unknown package.
I got real respect for Becky, man. I sparred her loads. So I'm grateful that she took the fight. And I'm grateful that I won, man. I've been going through a lot, so it just shows to go that, like, whatever you go through, just keep moving forward and you'll succeed, because boxing's all I got at the minute, so I just feel like the win has pushed me through.
You could tell that at the end when Sean Messer raises you, and you could see how much it meant to you.
Yeah, it means a lot to me, man. It's all I do, it's all I train for. Yeah, just go to show, man. Whatever you go through, mental health, whatever goes on in your life, man, you got to keep going and it'll come. Like karma, putting in the karma. So hopefully I've done well. Like, yeah.
You must have done quite well, because you almost got Errol Johnson in the ring for a photo. So that's got to be the next game.
Yeah, Errol's been a massive part of the last two camps, especially during fight camp. So I'm glad I've gone back to BCB and I'm glad I've gone back to the headquarters, especially with Paul Mann, you know. He's a very good guy, inspirational to me, so I'm glad to have them, all of them on board, all at BCB are just so welcoming. And the gym there is just the best gym I've been to.
And just finally for you, a Wolverhampton girl, fighting here in Wolverhampton, must mean the world.
Yeah, man, I'm a massive Wolves fan, been playing for Wolves since God knows how long, playing football, so being here as well, that's two wins on the bounce at Anger, so I love being here. Yeah, I love Wolves with Wolverhampton.
Look forward to seeing you make it a hat-trick. Well done, Kirsty.
Osborne Edwards, Jermaine, fascinating backstory hearing from him the week in the build up to this fight. Incredibly well known in Wolverhampton, someone who's first to acknowledge that he's used boxing to really improve his life, and he's got a huge amount of support here this evening for his professional debut. Bass is shaking the cameras there, that's how loud it's got in here. Yeah, the guys on the stage, you have to hold on to those a bit. A huge amount of support in here for Jermaine Osborne Edwards. So this one's scheduled for four rounds. MJ Hall, who's been here and done it all, he's been in with so many good guys, so many fighters over the years. This will be a very new experience for Jermaine. And again, he's got to try and handle the crowd noise, the crowd pressure, and not get too over eager.
Yeah, he's a very popular lad. And what's funny is that a lot of these guys that are here are very familiar faces. I've went to school with them, or I know from Wolverhampton. He's such a popular lad.
I saw him earlier, Carl, what a popular lad Jermaine is. Speaking to him in the week, he's acknowledged how much boxing's done for him personally. Getting him on it on the straight and narrow. And you can see he's got massive support.
You think this is a massive support waiting to see Conor Walker come out tonight? Dear me.
Yeah, a lot of the VIP tables full of Conor Walker fans. Really come out and back their guy this evening, and I think they've been rewarded, because once you lose that main event, it would have been very easy to put Conor in with someone like an MJ Hall, someone with lots of experience, but that he's only going to do so much. But they've put him in with someone who's unbeaten.
They've put him in with a true customer. But you know what, that's Conor Walker though. Conor Walker doesn't want easy fights. Conor Walker wants to climb the ladder and build his career, so he wouldn't want to fight like this tonight. He wants the hardest fights he can get.
Yeah, he certainly sounds the part. Conor talks very calm, very professionally. And so we spoke to him on the podcast last week, and he seemed very ready for the challenge. Obviously looking to defend that Midlands title that he won against Levi Ferguson in the outdoor show in Sheffield.
Good fight that was.
Yeah, close fight on the card.
Obviously Levi Ferguson's under Errol Johnson and Paul Mann, and obviously both fighters are managed by Errol Johnson. Good shots there. Good shots, very good shots by Jermaine.
Jermaine fighting out that southpaw stance.
Jermaine looks very big, his back is massive.
MJ Hall, you may find him switch hitting, moving. Very awkward customer, very tricky fighter.
MJ Hall, a guy that came from white collar, has had a lot of experience now in the professional ranks, fighting on the road, fought a lot of top prospects coming through. So this will be a good test for Jermaine. Jermaine's showing though, he wants to push on the front foot and really impose himself on MJ Hall.
Left hand falling a little bit short there from Jermaine, but you can see the intent certainly there. And again, key thing we keep saying from that southpaw is about putting the combination together, not just relying on single punches.
I tell you what I would say is I'm quite impressed with the way Jermaine settled into the fight. When you come out and you've got a massive crowd behind you, you can sometimes be caught in them headlights, as they say, like a hedgehog?
Yep. Doing the lights.
And he's settled into it. You can see he's very calm. He's got straight down to business, and he hasn't allowed the crowd to affect him, which is that's really good. Because as his career goes on and progresses, the support's only going to get bigger.
Yeah, MJ Hall popping out that right hand. And again, he just moves so well, Hall, doesn't he? Now his footwork is good, and you know Jermaine's going to have to really think about the punches that he's throwing to land anything clean.
Yeah, because Hall is just out of range every time you throw, so sometimes you can make it overcommit. Jermaine's doing quite well here. He's being very patient. He's picking his shots. He's trying to work the range. He's trying to edge his feet in into position. What I do like to see though is MJ Hall is still having a go. He's not having a go. He's not covering up and just moving around, which makes for an exciting fight. He's posing questions of Jermaine.
Yeah. First round of professional career in the bank for Jermaine. He's dancing a little bit in the corner.
Richard Carter won't like that though.
I was going to say, yeah, Richard with a slightly stern look on his face.
Richard Carter won't like that because he'll want his man to be focused. He'll want his man to be switched on. And as a coach and as a fighter myself, of course he's playing to his crowd, he's playing to his fans that have come to support him. And obviously he's very grateful for that. But as the coach, you want your man to be switched on, engaged, in exactly what's in front of you.
We touched a little bit earlier, Kyle, on Richie Carter's involvement in the area. Obviously, a former professional fighter himself, running a really successful, stable gym at the moment.
He's doing well. And to be fair, Andy Owen, another one of his boxers, who's just recently second pro fight, he's one of the coaches down there as well. They're building a good little stable of pro fighters as well as amateurs as well. So obviously Cooper was under them, Jerome's under them, and they also had Lewis Morris on tonight.
The guy's matching up.
Good shots there by Jerome. He went high to low with his hooks.
And again, talk about the style matchup here again, Carl. You've now got southpaw against southpaw. What sort of challenges does that give each fighter?
It's very hard for us to get southpaw sparring as it is, let alone to be a southpaw yourself, and then to get another southpaw to spar you. It's going to be hard, but listen, boxing's boxing.
Yeah. MJ Hall, he's just not quite extending that jab.
Good shot there.
He's punished for it there, Carl.
Again, MJ Hall's not a lad that gets stopped that often either, is he?
Good left hand through there, the goal by Jermaine.
So this is where my worry is for Jerome. He's now landing, and he's starting to get a bit of success. Don't get slack. Don't get loose.
A little bit of eagerness there as Hall tucked his hands behind his back, as they just letting him know that he's still got a lot to do before he lands.
It's so hard when you've got the whole crowd behind you and they're willing you on, and all I want to see again is that knockout. Listen, learn your rounds, learn your craft.
Both men exchanging shots.
And if it comes, let it happen.
A Hall missing widely, and Jermaine did quite well there. You know, he kept his hand high, he didn't allow himself to get caught with anything clumsy inside.
I'll tell you what, for how big he is, he moved his feet quite well there. He circled off MJ Hall and found a new angle. He's got good feet, and for how stocky he moves quite well on his feet. He showed some real good lateral movement tonight so far.
Yeah, he ducks out of that jab. Sometimes good with the head movement as well.
Obviously, he carries a lot of muscle. He does carry a lot of muscle, and sometimes that can make you a little bit stiff. That shot there was MJ a little bit off balance, not so much that he was hurt.
Yeah, I think the crowd will have enjoyed that one, but as you say, it was more feet than anything else there, and Hall has regained his composure perfectly fine. Left hand missing wildly there. He's just got to get back on that knee to stuff again, you know, targeting the body, looking more downstairs. To try and headhunt against someone like MJ Hall as he's doing now. He's doing duck out of those jabs. 3-4 punches there missing. It must be very difficult for Jermaine to not get frustrated. Slightly less exuberant dancing in the corner there. I think as the rounds go on, that may slow to a halt.
Rich Carter's got a hard job here. Rich Carter's got a hard job here because he's got to manage his fighter as well as managing his people that's calling his ear to get the way out of there. Richard Carter's got to try and get his fighter to listen to his game plan and not his crowd's game plan.
Yeah, exactly. And it's the crowd to understand their expectations. They want to see a knockout. They want to see Hall hit the deck. But it's very, very, very unlikely that we'll see that in the next couple of rounds.
Obviously, Rich Carter, this is his first bunch of pro fighters, right? So it's good that poor man's there just to be that whisper in the ear that's been in a lot of pro corners. Just to give that little bit of guidance to Richie as well. Because listen, this is a big night for Richie as well.
Yeah, huge amount of experience in poor man, BCB's head trainer.
Listen, Rich Carter's been there and done it himself, and he's fought on some big, some very, very high levels. I'm not knocking his knowledge, but he's going to be very eager for his fighter to perform and impress as well. So sometimes that quiet word in the ear of someone that's in corners all the time, week in, week out, that sees thousands of fights a year, I'm sure Paul Mann will help the corner team get through it as well. That's something that's always been big in my career that I've had to give credit to. I've had to always give credit to my corner people. It's not just the fighter, the team behind you is so important.
Yeah, it's a vital role, and those few seconds in between the rounds, the right advice can be the difference between winning and losing.
Listen, I remember when I fought Thomas Asamba, I think I got put down in round one, and if it wasn't for Errol and Paul getting me ready and my mind focused again, I wouldn't have won that English title. So I was completely gone against Thomas Asamba in that first round. And the team behind me steadied my mind and got me back in the fight.
Back to the action in the ring, and Hall falls short with the right hand there. Again, the pace dropping off a little bit in the third.
Yeah, again, I think Jerome came out very fast, didn't he? Tried to really show his presence, and I think he's feeling the pace. Again, this is his debut, so you expect him to feel the pace.
Yeah, short hand inside.
Good shot there, though. Good short left hand.
Yeah, Hall ducking low with that left hand. That's not a shot you'll see in any kind of boxing textbook there. Head down and throwing shots over the top, but the right hand landed to some degree.
The pace has dropped somewhat, though, hasn't it?
Certainly has. I think Jermaine is struggling to kind of work the angles and trying to work out to get inside.
I tell you what, Jerome has got very good feet. He has got good feet. He's shown at times when MJ Hall has attacked him. He's spun off really well. I think where he's lacking is when he's attacking, he doesn't attack with angles. he defends with angles, but not so necessary. See there, he slipped the shot, spun him off. But what he's not doing is, when he's attacking, he's not giving his angles with his feet.
Hall starting to get a little bit of the better of the exchanges now, and he's certainly leading off first.
See, and Jerome's a little bit frustrated. You saw then he's kind of slapped MJ Hall's hand. You can see that round by Jerome's corners, there's a lot of people.
And certainly, it's a lot of, yeah.
And really, what you want to see is the three cornermen. Yeah. You can see there's a heavy presence there. And me as a coach, I don't want no one near my fire.
I think it's the fourth and final round of this one. Again, we've got one more bout to go before our main event. Alex Rao takes on Kieran Thomas next. And then Conor Walker is in with Jack Eubank in our main event.
MJ Hall's up very early. MJ looks fresh. But then again, he does this week in, week out.
I think it was proposed years ago, but never came to any fruition, about a journeyman prize fighter style tournament. I'd love to get a chance to see the likes of MJ Hall, Kevin McCauley,
and have their night.
They can really go. I'd love to see that.
Yeah, and have their night of glory. Yeah. I think that'd be such, yeah, maybe that can happen.
And Jermaine's fans stood up all around the arena, patiently watching their man, who's won the first three rounds of this one. But he's now looking for those openings.
It's been a good performance against a tricky opponent that's very experienced. So Jerome can take a lot away from this performance. It's been a good performance.
The crowd seemed excited by that one, mate. I think it just brushed the top.
Yeah, it brushed off. It didn't affect MJ Hall at all. Mm. And this is what I'm trying to say. Sometimes, actually, seeing it and actually really seeing it is two things. Like, we had that comment about Babington's fight. It's very different when you're up close and personal.
Yeah, and the referee certainly won't be swayed by the crowd. A very, very experienced ref. And he'll be scoring it based on what he's seeing from a few feet away.
Yeah, but I tell you what, I'm very impressed with Jerome's footwork. He's got some slick moves in there. I would like to see him a bit more slick on the front foot. He's very slick on the back foot, but not so much the front.
Yeah, and he just popped a couple of jabs out there again, showing that bit of patience that he needs.
See, MJ hasn't really posed a threat to him when he's attacked, because Jerome's very slippery on the back foot. Oh.
Oh, misses with that right hand inside and throws a left.
That was a good shot. That was a good shot over the top. Can he sustain a little bit of pressure now? Give this crowd that are really egging him on to get the guy out of there. Can he sustain a little bit more pressure here?
Yeah, certainly he looks fresh in the feet. He's still moving well, but I don't know whether it's starting to get tired arms in there. There are less punches coming.
Yeah. Again, Jerome can be very happy with this debut. He's done some good things in there tonight, showed some good footwork, picked some shots, some really good shots at times.
And again, Hall's experience, just knowing when to call the action and when to slow it down. He's letting, again, the shots come in and then just creating that distance. Good night's work from MJ Hall.
MJ Hall puts his hands up almost like he's won the fight. I'm not too sure.
No, I certainly don't think he's...
I don't see that. Maybe MJ Hall's just saying that he knows he had success in there. Maybe that's what he's saying, I don't know.
Yeah, certainly an exuberant finish in the middle of the ring there from Jermaine Osborne Edwards.
Yeah, he's definitely a character, isn't he?
Yeah, as I say.
And you can see why he's probably a fan favourite.
Yeah.
He's probably the life of the party when he goes out.
Very much so. As I say, very well known in the area. He looks very pleased with his performance. As
I say, if you get a chance to see and see the interviews with him, it's a fascinating story, Jermaine's. There's so many horror boxing, there's so many interesting stories when you just get a chance to speak to some of these guys and the journeys that they've been on just to get to this point. I'm not quite sure what the feather's about. I'm sure Dan will probably get a chance to ask him that.
Sure what?
40 points to 36. Steady performance from Jermaine Osborne Edwards. He certainly looks happy with his night's work.
It's very interesting that there's a few supporters around us that say that this should have been a draw. I don't personally see that.
No, again, I'm always the optimist. I always like to look to see for what the opponent does. I don't think that Hall got.
To be fair, Richard Carter's walking back and he doesn't look as happy. Again, listen, I scored it as Jerome had took the fight. But yeah.
We'll just head over to Dan now.
Jermaine, how do you feel?
Brilliant. My spirit guide is with me today. Okopaka Shakaina!
You got some fans here today as well, mate. Unbelievable numbers today. How do you feel finally making that pro debut?
Mate, I feel amazing. I feel emotional now. You know what I mean? Come a long way, man.
We know that boxing saved you.
Yeah, man.
Tonight, do you feel saved?
I feel saved, man. I have my spirit guide with me. Okoba Shakaina, Rakashana Gunaye. I have my spirit guide with me. And my ancestors guiding me all the time.
In terms of your opponent, MJ Hall, very experienced, very tough.
Very experienced, lad. I couldn't knock him out. He was hard out to box. I showed my skills. So anyway, everyone that doubted me, yeah, I did it. Yeah, I'm emotional now.
And you'll still be able to continue to do
I'm
it.
Fighting again before Christmas.
Where does the pro path take you?
I want a belt, like my best friend Connor's got. I want that belt. Yeah.
In terms of the crowd tonight, there's a lot of Jermaine Osborne Edwards fans here just to see the caveman. Yeah. What have you got to say to them?
Thank you for supporting me and being there all the way. I love you. And stay with me all the way and I'll put on the show every time. Wow.
Jermaine, really looking forward to the ride. Well done tonight. See you at the next one.
Thank you, love you. God bless.
Take care.
I just say, the guy just come out to my tune. I'm not very happy. That's made me want to fight tonight now. I'd like to have a word with Earl Johnston and say that should have been banned.
It's the unofficial Carl Wolverhampton anthem.
Yes. Earl just said I gave up my place on the show, so I can't expect to have the song. So.
Jump in your seat, it's quick, I tell you.
I must say, my fans did it better.
I think if I play the box, I'd end up walking out like Homer Simpson, so why can't we be friends?
Kieran Thomas again, a very experienced lad under Gavin Burrows. Rich Carter's been a very busy man tonight. I think this is his fourth man on the show, on the card.
And what a couple of years Gavin Burrows has had. Fantastic, certainly was always a good trainer, he had a good stable going over there, and he's got a bit of national acclaim with his work with Rachel Ball, also working with Katie Healy as well. And we're in for this one again, 4 3-minute rounds, Alex Round in with Kieran.
Rachel Ball's become a very good poster girl for Gavin, really, for his gym and what he's done. Rachel Ball's done really well.
And I hope we get to see Rachel back in soon. You know, she had such a good bit of momentum going, and obviously knocked back by COVID and the illness. It's been difficult, but hopefully she'll get back in the ring soon.
It seems to have all fell apart for Rachel. She had the pandemic, COVID, injuries. I'm sure she'll be back though. She worked so hard. I'm sure she'll be back. Alex Round has started very, very fast, getting into his man, mixing up his shots.
Steady work there from both men again, both keeping that really, really tight guard. Very high guard from both. Both sort of feeling each other out in the early stages.
Yeah, it's very tight. It's very nip and tuck, isn't it?
Yeah, very much so. Very cautious from both. I'm almost a little bit more surprised that from Kieran. You expect him probably to have a slightly more loose style again with that experience, but he's keeping those hands nice and high.
He seems like he's really trying to force his man back here.
like he hasn't looked cautious or anything. He's looked like he just wants to get into his man.
Quite clean work in a way, isn't it? You know, they're both fighting up close, but there's certainly no sign of the clinch.
And Kieran Thomas is not taking a step back. He's well up for this. It makes for a good fight.
Slightly scrappy now from both, little right hand inside there.
It's because they're both trying to impose themselves in there. That's all it is.
Yeah, it's a bit of a battle of strength as much as boxing at the moment, but that's a bit better work. Good right hand over the top. Short body shot in reply, but
Alex Ryan's the one that's pushing the man back. But Kieran Thomas is doing some good work on the back foot there.
Looked like a bit of a clash of heads, but no reaction to it, nothing from the referee. Together there.
Good body shot there by Kieran Thomas. Alex Ryan's just pouring with that jab a little bit. I'd like him to be a little bit stiff with it and force his man back. Get his man to stand up a little bit more right.
Yeah, it's the adage, everything comes off that jab, doesn't it? If you get your jab going, it gives you the opportunity to let your hands go more.
I feel because Alex Ryan's jab was a little bit poor in that first round, it allowed Kieran just to stay in there. It didn't force his man up and to cover up, so it allowed Kieran to come back with an answer to that jab.
Yeah,
a little bit of a lazy jab.
You hear a lot of trainers use that expression about fighting in the pocket, and it's if you're allowed to get in there, if that jab isn't effective, you get a lot of work done.
Yeah, so my instruction from Richard Carr right now in the first interval would be a little bit sterner with that jab. Force him back, double it up and press him, and then look to go up and round.
Both men up and off the stools. Not exerted too much energy in that one.
A lot of flurry there from Kieran Thomas. Not really much landing, more arm shots than anything, but still a sign of that he's going to have a go.
And it's giving Ryan something to think about, isn't it?
Good left hook there.
Got to keep that guard high.
Kieran Thomas rolled out and stood up very high. I tell you what, Kieran Thomas fancies his fight today. He's really trying to back his man up this round. He was the one that was on the back foot in the first round, but this round it seems like he's come out quite fast out of the blocks and trying to push his man back.
Yeah, certainly being very active, nothing particularly clear getting through, working away more at the body, but the need to work though is coming from the other corner, isn't it?
Well, 100%, yeah. Some good body shots there off his backhand to Kieran Thomas. Alex Ryan just picking that. If you notice, he keeps going around the back of that elbow of Kieran Thomas, Alex Ryan does. Hard shot to stop, that is. But this is not an easy bout. No. This is a back and forth bout that both men are very, very much in it.
Yeah, again, good neat work inside. Again, the more success seems to be coming when he's going to the body. That's where the space is. That's where the opportunities are to land the point scoring shots. If not the concussive big shots, it's the point scoring ones he needs.
Alex Ryan has really got a backhand hook to the body. It's working really, really well. He needs to play that a little bit more, for my liking. That was a good uppercut there, as Kieran was trying to push his man back. It was just a little bit high, and Alex Ryan just caught him with that sharp little uppercut.
Yeah, good spirits in there so far from both men.
A little bit of coming together. Oh, good uppercuts from both men there. Both caught each other very cold.
Something you don't tend to see, both leading with an uppercut off a first shot.
This is a very entertaining fight. It's very back and forth. This is going to have people split again. It's going to be a pick and fight. It's what you like, I suppose.
Yeah, And I think it's fair to say, normally it's quite obvious to see that the prospect and the journeyman, that certainly hasn't been the case so far. I think if you were a neutral observer who had never seen the records and never seen either man fight, you'd certainly see it quite close.
I would say that Alex Ryan is doing the more work, so I would edge him on my scorecard. That was a nice little throw. But again, Kieran Thomas comes straight back. But yeah, I would have Alex Ryan ahead. He's picking some lovely shots out of his bag.
As you said earlier, it's that short right to the body, isn't it? That's a real nice clean punch he's got there, and he landed it well at the end of that one.
He's getting around the back of that elbow, which is hard to stop.
So for those watching us live, we still have our main event to come this evening. Conor Walker in with Jack Eubank. Jack, familiar to those who have watched some of the MTK shows. Someone who is an unbeaten prospect. He's had a little bit of time out of the ring, as COVID, as so many fighters have, given this opportunity on 48 hours notice. And these guys, we say, nothing to lose. It's going to be a really interesting main event, one I'm really looking forward to. Fight so far, Alex Round with the cleaner, better work, but he's certainly been given plenty to think about by Kieran Thomas.
Good little short left hook there by Alex Round. Alex Round looks like he's trying to step the pace up this round. Good body hook there again. Yeah. That's three in a row, and that has been the telling shot in this fight so far for me.
Yeah, and Thomas is either seeing unable to kind of tuck his elbow close enough to his side, maybe he doesn't want to give up that left side of his face for the switch upstairs.
Messi giving
open for three body shots, as you say.
Messi giving round a bit of a turning off for using his forearm. Good little short uppercut there by Thomas.
Mayweather used a career out of using that forearm to effect, so.
He did indeed. He's still TBE for me though, still the best ever. Yeah, Alex Ryan seems like he's going for the gears here, and it looks like Kieran Thomas is feeling the pace a little bit.
Yeah, Thomas's defence is getting a little bit sloppy, a little bit more open.
Yeah.
The punch is starting to rain in.
You know what, if this carries on the way it is, I believe that Alex Ryan will get him out of here. He's looking a little bit sharper there, a little bit cuter. He's putting his shots together very well, and Kieran Thomas's defence is starting to demise, I should say.
What I like about what Round's doing is he's getting his shots in, but then he's taking that step back, popping his guard back up, and then going back in, as we saw earlier with a couple of the guys making their debut.
Over-eagerness. Yeah, I tell you what's done the work here for Alex Round is damn body shots early. It really slows the man down and takes a lot of, you know, and I believe. See, there you go again. He's showing to feel that one. That right hand of his, the hook, he throws it so well.
And again, he was allowed then to switch back upstairs because of that.
Oh, see there again. He keeps going two upstairs. See, don't get over eager, because what you're doing is working.
Yeah, he missed a little bit there with that overhand right. And again, a couple of shots now. Good shot to the
body. There you go, he felt it. He needs to step the pace up now because he's felt that shot there. Yeah. Go to the body again.
Big intake of breath there. Now I'm pouring the shots on now.
I see him getting stopped here. He really got hurt with that body shot. If he can land one more of those. You got to give credit to Kieran Thomas here for biting down on his gum shield and getting through this round.
Yeah, very tough man. And he's got a bit of a wry smile on his face. I think he knows he's been in with a tough night's work today.
I tell you what though, both men look like it's been a hard battle. They're both looking a little bit tired in there. Round put a lot of work in that round. He put a lot of effort into that. Yeah. So, can he come out for the last round and really really push the pace?
This
one really has flown by, because we're already entering our fourth and final round. In a good all-action fight. As you say, Kieran Thomas started off well, but he's had some of the momentum knocked out of him a little bit by Alex Round, and that was a...
Yeah, Alex Round really went for the gears in that round, but at the last moment he looked a little bit leggy. So I'm hoping he gets the second win now, and he can really put on a spectacular finish. It's been a grueling fight for both men though. Both men have really put it on the line there tonight. Both really tried to impose themselves. It's been a good little fight, to be honest.
Yeah, Thomas quite quick out the blocks, landed a punch straight after the bell, and then landed a nice little right hand. Again, just caught a little bit inside. He's...
So this is the kind of opponent Alex Round will want. He'll want his man to open up, because that's where the gaps are. That's where the openings are for you to potentially get a stoppage. It's whether we can put the shots together to get him out of there.
And he's landing his punches at a higher percentage as well. You know, he's not wasting too many shots. He is picking
good body shot again. Good overhand right. Yes, see, he's going through the gears here. He really is trying to get his man out of there. Good right hand there. Just a little bit crowded on his shots.
Yeah, again, better defence there from Thomas. He tucked himself in well to those body shots.
He's took some really good shots tonight, Thomas has, to be honest. Round has really gave it to him at times. Good right hand there. Oh, good body shot. I'm really impressed with Round's body shots tonight. I think he's gone to the body very, very well.
Yeah, he's seen what's worked and he's stuck with it. You know, he's not being guilty of headhunting, but where he is, just as I say that, you know, he comes up quite short. And I think Thomas is going to get on his bike now for the rest of the round.
I'll tell you what though, it has been a grueling fight, and you can see on both of their faces, they've felt the pace of this bout. But very interesting. Again, not a 40, not a standard 40-36.
No, far from it. It's been enjoyable on this one.
Again, they've, nice both had, they've both at times both had success in there.
Nice stiff jab from Round there.
I mean, I expect Round to take all the rounds here, personally. But that doesn't say that Kieran Thomas has not had success in there, because he has. At times, he's give as good as he's got. So, credit where credit is due.
Round opening up there, standing himself quite square on, flicking that jab and a nice left-hand right combination.
If I'm honest, I want to see Thomas get through this now, because he's really dug deep at times.
He's looking,
but Alex really is pushing the pace here.
He is.
Oh, it's a count.
Oh, no.
No.
No. No. Sean Messer, a strange signal from Sean now.
I think he said that he used the forearm again, I think. Yeah. He pushed him back.
I wasn't sure if it was forearm or whether it was. That was the signal from Sean, but I think it was just a loose right hand. I don't think it was an intentional forearm.
I thought he really had him going there, and then a little few seconds of Messer splitting them up, I think. Just gave.
So that was the breathing move he needed.
Thomas, he gave Thomas a little chance to recover there. That was a very good bout, very back and forth. I give Alex Round all four rounds, but not to discredit the work that Kieran Thomas put in. Kieran Thomas put in a good display of himself there, dug deep at times, and gave as good as he got.
Yeah, I expect that to be a 40-36 round. About 2 rounds. Thomas looks pleased with his night's work. And we wait for the referee to bring the two men together. Well, not one bout, it was a final bout before our mate MC Ricky Wright with the scorecard. Takes it 40 points to 36. Referee Sean Messer called for the crowd to give a round of applause to both men before that score was given, an indication of just how much he enjoyed that one himself. Alex will be speaking to Dan very shortly, and it's the build-up to that big main event. Conor Walker, Jack Newbank over six rounds.
Alex, congratulations.
Thank you.
Great debut. How are you feeling?
Brilliant. Loved it. Absolutely loved it. My atmospheres were electric. Give my all then. Trying hard for this. Never thought I'd turn pro, but finally did it in a debut like that. Thank you to everyone, my family, friends, everyone here. Richie Carter. Been there for me from day one. Massive respect to Kieran Thomas as well and everyone at BCB. Like yourself. Thank you very much.
It's a great, great start. And like you say, a great person to fight against, Kieran Thomas. Because he's game.
Yeah, mate, he's a lovely, lovely, lovely person. We had a chat before the fight, like, he's that nice. We get on that well. But you know what? Absolute cracking person. Be mates with him for life.
And in terms of that debut, you've probably thought about it a long time. You're a massive Wolves fan. You're from Wolverhampton. Here it is. How are you feeling?
Great, absolutely brilliant. Over the moon. Thank you to everyone. I mean, I love you all. Thank you.
And it was a good debut as well. You boxed well at times. And obviously, there's a bit of adrenaline in there. Once you calmed yourself down and got behind your jab and worked well then, you pleased with your performance?
Unreal, loved it, loved every second. Can't wait for the next one.
Just looking at the next one in terms of tonight, the main event next, Conor Walker versus Jack Newbank. How'd you see that going?
Conor Walker all day, Conor Walker. I actually looked up to Conor Walker when I was amateur. So to be on the same show with him is an absolute honour. Well, he's a cracking person and his opponent, nice person, spoke to him, brilliant person. Best of luck to both of them.
Well done on your debut, you top man. Well done, Alex.
So here we go, it's our main event of the evening. That background on this story, Jack Eubank, who hasn't boxed for a good while, unbeaten fighter, took an opportunity on just a couple of days' notice, stepping in after Conor Walker's original opponent was forced out, Jamie Stewart, forced out with an issue with a brain scan. Jack stepped up, took this opportunity. He really has nothing at all to lose in there, but if he wins, he'll have beaten the Midlands champion, and many more opportunities for him will come. He's just about to make his walk to the ring now. He'll be going into the bear pit. Conor Walker's got a huge amount of support, but it's safe to say that Jack's brought his own people with him. He doesn't lose. Looks for a bit of an entourage here, Carl. I never saw you walk with the 25 people behind you. I don't think you really needed it, did you?
Conor Walker's a great lad, and he's a popular lad around these areas, so, you know, I'm a fan of Conor Walker's myself. He was in the same year as my sister at school, so I've grown up around Conor Walker. He's a lovely lad. He works very, very hard, and that's why you can see the numbers come out for him. This will be a tricky fight for Conor, but one that I expect him to come through with shining colours. Thing is, his corner man, Richard Gaines, is a West Brom fan. His manager is a West Brom fan.
Well, they'll be singing the same song, just in reverse.
So listen, but hey, I'm on Conor Walker's team. I don't like my manager's team either. And it has to be said, Wolves Awe.
I ain't, but yes, Wolves Awe.
Wolves Awe.
Packed in here tonight.
It's really good to see the people getting behind Conor Walker. The popularity of this kid, it just shows what kind of person he is. He's a lovely lad, down to earth, and you know, I'm glad that the people get behind him. He's looked good in his opening few fights. He's won the Midlands area title, so let's hope he can push on here tonight, and let's hope he keeps his own and takes someone else's.
No stranger to headlining shows yourself. What's that added pressure like, being at the top of the bill?
It's something that you taking your stride, I would definitely say, but you, listen, it's all been building for him, hasn't it? The whole night's been building behind Conor Walker, the expectations on his shoulders, the fans are there for him. His opponents just come in, and really, what's he got to lose? He's got his own to lose, yeah, but he's not in front of his fans. He's away from home. The whole city that's in this room right now is on Conor's shoulders. So I understand that. You want to perform not just for your own career, but you want to perform for the people as well. Both guys look well up for this. Richard Gaines again, a good coach in Conor Walker's corner. I actually started training with Richard Gaines before I actually decided to go with Tyler Shakespeare and then over to Errol Johnson. Richard Gaines, no stranger to the ring. good start by Conor there. Good stiff jab downstairs.
Yep, so here we go. Six rounds, our main event. Conor again. Walker with the sparkly shorts.
Good sharp jab. Oh, yes. He's making his man look reckless already. That jab. Oh, good left hook again.
Eubank in the right hand. Walker has it down early off the right hand. It was a short right hand inside there that Eubank is
trying. Conor Walker has started very goddamn fast here. He started so fast. Coming with a lovely left hook.
Yeah, Eubank's going to have to.
This fight ain't going to last long.
No, he's going to have to really think about what he's doing here, Eubank. As I say, taking out
Conor's power. Conor looks very powerful in there. He's troubling with his jab. His jab is so sturdy and so strong that he's causing problems for Eubank all night.
Yeah, it was the
Conor
right.
Conor can't get reckless though. He got caught then himself.
It was the right hand that put him down, but to be fair to Eubank, he seems to have gathered his senses a little bit and he's fighting a bit of fire with fire earlier.
Good start for Conor. Conor needs to settle into this bout now. He's only two rounds up. Well, very, very good start for Conor there.
Chopping right hand there from Walker.
Oh, he's got again.
No.
He still needs a push.
Yeah,
but listen, I'm telling you now, Eubank doesn't look like he's interested.
Yeah,
he doesn't look interested at all.
Yeah, I think that was the right call from the referee. It was definitely a shot behind the back of the head, but he looks a bit startled here, Eubank.
Eubank does not look interested at all. He looks very disengaged.
Yeah, it was a long look over at his corner there. We basically said to him off the
Oh, he's caught him again. He's gone. He's gone.
Combination there from Walker and Eubank is down. He's under long.
It's over. It's over. It's over. It's over.
Yeah, lean up.
The referee has to wave this off. I'm very disappointed in the referee there. He's gone, ref.
That's it. The towel's in.
First
round stoppage for Conor Walker. Very easy night's work. He put his shots together well, Kyle, but you have to say, a little bit disappointing from Eubank.
From the first shot that Conor threw though downstairs, you could see it worried Eubank. He just didn't look like he was engaged at all. The first jab to the body seemed to trouble him. That right hand over the top. And you can see why this crowd is behind this man here.
Yeah, we've got to give credit where it's due there to Walker. He put his shots together really nicely. He didn't go over the top. He didn't just settle for big punches. He set himself up nicely.
I tell you what, I think the built-up aggression from maybe not getting the title fight, but the fight that he planned for so many weeks, I think that just showed out in that fight there.
Yeah, very fair point there, Carl. Conor's had to put up with a difficult week, all this change, last minute change of opponent.
Listen,
dropping from 10 to 6 rounds.
So what I heard on Wednesday, I heard that he was planning he was going to be a case of he wasn't going to fight, and he's going to have to let all his fans down. This big night that he's headlining is now gone. So I reckon that frustration has just come out in the ring, and Eubank's been on the end of that. Great performance by Conor, very devastating, and now he needs to push on. He needs a big fight now. He's just took someone's out. He needs a big fight.
Yeah, when you head into the double digits of the career, that's when these sort of the title fights and as you experienced yourself, those English level fights, this is the time now where it needs to start happening for Conor Walker.
I'd like to see him for an English. Eubank's up, that's good. He seems in good spirits. Both fighters come together and enjoy, so that's good. You know what? All credit to Eubank as well, who took the final 48 hours notice. You know,
nearly 2 years out of the ring. Difficult. It was always going to be difficult for him.
So, and Conor's very much on the. He's rising, isn't he? So, credit to Eubank for taking the fight. And allowing these fans to come out and see their homeboy favourite.
Because it's safe to say that there may well be people who watched at home online who have criticised Eubank's performance, but the show owes an awful lot to him. Without Eubank stepping in, as you say at this short notice, we wouldn't have had a main event.
Yeah, it's all about where Conor Walker goes next now, Errol's got a real big job on his hands now to secure him a big fight. He's obviously got the following, he's obviously got the people behind him. So, let's see what Errol can produce from now. So for a big fight back here.
Richard further away in the comments, he just put Florian now. Calling out Florian Marker, who's a very popular fighter, obviously fighting on Sky Sports regularly.
I think that is a fight that could easily be made. But is it one that Marker would want? Because, let's be honest, he didn't look very good in his last performance. And Connor's just come off a stinging performance there.
Marker, who struggled a little bit with Prodan, it's safe to say. One of the judges giving it 9 rounds to 1 for Prodan's favour. But there'll be a lot of guys. It's a popular weight division, especially in the UK. There's a lot of options for him. Walker certainly just off a couple of cobwebs after a few months' gap since he last fought Levi Ferguson. I mean, there could well be options. I mean, there are a lot of people calling for the Ferguson rematch because the first was so close. Can you imagine how, Kyle, that Conor's going to want to take that step above?
Listen, Conor Walker's not going to want to look backwards. And no disrespect to Levi Ferguson, who, again, I trained with him in the gym. Lovely lad. Really, he's a good prospect himself. Conor's going to want to push on now. And unfortunately for Levi, he's going to have to earn his stripes again in order to get that chance at Conor. That's just the way the business works.
I'm kind of heading over now, soon be speaking with Dan. Thank you for everyone so far that's joined the stream.
Conor Walker's being mobbed outside his outside the ring.
It might take a few minutes for him to get down to us here, Kyle. Those that have liked and subscribed the page, BCB regularly broadcast shows for free online. You know, you get to see some great action. A lot of young prospects, a lot of experienced fighters. We get a nice mix on our shows. So thank you for everyone that's watched.
What an explosive end to the night.
Absolutely. After some fairly what we might call routine 4 and 6 rounders,
Sure. We
get that explosive bout to finish us off.
And it keeps this city pumping. It keeps this city wanting more.
That's what you need. Entertainment and wins. It's a simple combination. Walker can keep that going. We'll be well the way.
Connor, that was quick.
Yeah, fucking hell, wasn't it? That's good, isn't it?
Absolutely unbelievable. The electric atmosphere and the electric finish to what's been an electric evening. You must be absolutely buzzing.
Yeah, I mean, I found the target straight away. And then the crowd just brings a spot out in you, doesn't it, man? And yeah, it was good. I enjoyed it, man. I loved every minute of it. Well, was it a minute?
2 minutes. A bit like my sex life. It was over quicker than I thought it would.
Yeah.
It was a perfect start for you, the way that you just put yourself in there amongst it. You just really showed your power against Jack Eubank, and he just didn't look like he wanted to be in there once he felt that first punch.
Yeah, that's it. And that was the plan all along. Just stick it out there, put him on the end of it, see how he reacts. Yeah, I found the target, and that was that. Exactly. Florian Marku, get it, come on, let's have it.
It's been a strange week for you. Concentrating purely on Jamie Stewart, Midlands area, over 10 rounds. Phone call on Wednesday, everything changes. You must be absolutely delighted with the outcome because somebody's about to go tonight and it wasn't yours.
Yeah, definitely. He was obviously a dangerous opponent. He's had 4 wins. You know, he's a good boxer. I've watched him box. He's a good boxer. But, yeah, like I said, I think they found the target too early.
The Wolf certainly got to him here in Wolverhampton. What an atmosphere, by the way.
Oh, fucking hell, man. I had goosebumps coming out, man. It was just beautiful. Honestly, God, I can't explain it.
We spoke in the week about the Liquidator. I think it was the right choice in the end.
Yeah, definitely. 100% it was, man.
And a big word to your team, Richard Gent, Robert Wright, and the rest of the guys. They've really got you in great shape for tonight.
Yeah, I couldn't do without them, man. We work day in, day out in the gym for nights like this. And he's paid off.
In terms of what's next, if Jamie Stewart passes that brain scan, do you want him here in December?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, look at the atmosphere. I'd love to bring it back here. I'd fight here every day of the week if I can. It doesn't matter who. If it's not him, we'll have someone else. If it's not for the Midlands, we'll have another title. Let's just go with the flow and keep the momentum now.
Connor, you were outstanding tonight. You've been outstanding all week. Well done. Enjoy some time.
Dan just caught up there with Connor Walker. An incredibly impressive performance. Blew the guy away inside a round. It's been a great show. It's been a great night. What highlights for yourself?
That's got to be the highlight, hasn't it? Absolute. The cream, on the icing on the cake. A wonderful night. Wonderful atmosphere. We saw some great debutants. The likes of Jermaine Osborne Edwards. What a ticket seller he is, by the way. Alex Round, what a ticket seller he is, by the way. Ollie Cooper, what a ticket seller he is, by the way. Lewis Morris, what a ticket seller he is, by the way. Ethan Collins, what a ticket seller he is, by the way. Bavington sold a load of tickets as well, put in a great performance. Great, great undercard. And then you get that at the end, Paul. And that's what we're working for, nights like tonight and finishes like that.
Now, obviously, Conor Walker, as you just spoke to him then, that's what he's got to do against opponents like that in situations like this. If he wants to call out the likes of Florian Markham and others, he's got to be getting those statement wins and doing it in a decisive manner as he did.
Yeah, absolutely. But credit to Connor and his team. 2 days ago, they were preparing for a Midlands area title fight against Jamie Stewart. The opponent changes, 4-0. With the greatest respect to Jack Eubank, we hadn't heard of him 2 days ago, so Connor wouldn't have. But he's gone out there, he looked mean. He looked mean when I saw him on the pads before fight, and he looked mean as soon as he got in there. And as soon as he hit Jack Eubank, Jack didn't want to know.
I just want to say a quick word for Alex Round on that undercard. I thought it was a fantastic fight. Really good performance, really well measured. Of all the prospects seen tonight, I think he's one we really got to be looking out for.
Yeah, I thought all of them did really well, and I thought the matchmaking from Head of Boxing Errol Johnson was spot on again, because he put a lot of BCB's Road Warriors in the away corner, and they all come to fight, they all come to give people rounds. So it was a match made in heaven tonight. So we've had 7 great fights, and I'm just delighted that after the other fights have gone the distance, we've saw Conor Walker smash his man with inside a round.
And obviously we've got a huge amount of shows coming up. We'll be live streaming some of those events as well. What's next? When can we see our fans back out?
Well, before what's next, I just want to say as well a massive well done to Jack Eubank for taking the fight on such short notice. It's not easy coming to a venue like this. It's intimidating, it's hostile. The guy didn't know he was fighting 48 hours ago. He's put himself in the ring, and we've got to respect everybody who gets in the ring. So before we move on to what's next, I just want to say thank you, Jack Eubank, for saving the show tonight, and hopefully he's safe and hopefully he's well, and Conor Walker will move on to bigger and better things, as will BCB. We'll be back here in December. But before we're back in Wolverhampton, we've got 2 shows back-to-back in Birmingham on the 16th and 17th of October. So really looking forward to that, Paul.
Absolutely. So thank you once again for everyone that's joined the live stream this evening. From myself, Carl Williams and Dan Moll, I hope you've enjoyed it, and we'll see you next time. I'm gonna go get some more.